I just briefly inform you that the session chair of this session is Professor Dr. Lalu Prasad Paudel, co-chair Dr. Poonam Jalal, and rapporteur Jaya Lakshmi Singh. I have seen all of them here, so I welcome you in the front desk. I hand over this microphone to Chair Professor Dr. Lalu Prasad Paudel to conduct this session. Thank you.
In this session, we have two very important talks from very renowned scientists working in the Himalaya. The first talk will be by Professor Vishal Nath Upreti. I think his name is well known among all of us working in the Himalaya. Professor Upreti started his career as a geologist in 1973 at the Department of Mines and Geology, and later he shifted to the Trivandrum University in 1979, and he continuously served as a teaching faculty and researcher in the Trivandrum University for more than 30 years. So, and presently, he also served as a department head, geology head of the department in the Department of Geology at Trivandrum University for more than 14 years, and as a Dean of Institute of Science and Technology at Trivandrum University. Presently, he is fellow academician at the Nepal Academy of Science and Technology, and honorary member of Nepal Geological Society. He has received many national and international honors and awards. His research is mainly focused on geology, stratigraphy, and tectonics of the Himalaya, and he is equally contributing in the disaster risk management and disaster risk reduction in the Nepal Himalaya. So today he is going to talk about the evaluation of future seismic hazards in Nepal and the need for establishment of an earthquake early warning system. So, Professor Upreti, please.
In fact, this work of almost 30 years, 25 years, is a lot of collaborators from different countries, and I'm thankful to all of them, and in fact, it is a work together. You see, we had so recent earthquake, a big earthquake in Nepal, 2015 work earthquake, and we had almost 35 years of studies, seismic studies, geodetic and seismic studies, we all came to the conclusion that, we head towards a major or great earthquake in Nepal. And that happened actually on 25th of April. The government and people were warned well in advance and by the geoscientists. And that paid a lot, in fact. And I don't see here like Amod Mani Dixit, Dr. Amod Mani Dixit and his teams and say, and many of us were really struggling almost for 10 to 12 years on this aspect of, convincing the government and also awareness creation to the people. As a result of a decade of extensive public awareness, campaigns, preparedness for rescue and relief operations, with national, international agencies, involved. Finally, when the event came, we were very successful in a way, and we did much better in terms of disaster management. If we didn't have done that, if we didn't do that, perhaps we would have been in a very difficult condition. And even now, you see, Nepal has just successfully completed the reconstruction work very recently. Now, just think of Haiti. 2010 and the situation in Haiti because of one single earthquake. So you can imagine how serious thing that earthquake is. Just to show you where I was born, in village in east of Kathmandu, 50 kilometers in the Dolangar, little up. And this was the house which was constructed after 1934 earthquake by my grandfather. And they lived in tent for months, and then finally this was constructed. And after 1934, 2015, this is the house. and still it is like that. I haven't reconstructed it, but then imagine 40% of Nepal's houses are like that, and 7.8 is still we consider is not a big earthquake that we are expecting. So therefore, it is time that rather we are already late. After 2015, we have lost already 7 years to be strongly prepared now, much more than what we did before, including establishment of the early warning system, even for a greater impending earthquake. I would say greater impending earthquake. There is no way we can go away or we can sigh away with that big earthquake. Definitely, you know, every indication is that we're heading towards a big earthquake, probably, you know, magnitude over 8. So, a little bit of history, you know, thanks to the French government and their initiations, the first installment of seismic station was in 1978 under Das and France, which contributed to so much of our database. Then, on the basis of that, after 15 years of the establishment, the first MHT geometry of Kathmandu transect was known and revealed, and also more or less during the same time, Caltech came up, and also we had this GPS station for the first time. We have the real measurements of the GPS, you know, movement, vertical and horizontal movement in the Nepal Himalaya. And now we can see this is the current condition. We have over 40 stations. This is after Adhikari 2021. His PhD thesis, which is already published, in fact. And we can see now a lot of stations are there. And Shiva's work is here, this one. He's also, as he has already presented yesterday's work, a great work he's doing right now. And in addition to the, these are the GPS stations in Nepal. In addition to the Caltech, we started it through an university, NAST, started more GPS stations. Now we have 11 GPS stations under NAST and TU. And in fact, they were so crucial during the 2015 earthquake that we had in Kathmandu. And we are always, you know, struggling to train our people, capacity building. And this is what you see, this station that you see here is our students plus we all together are making, and this was established long time before. And this is after earthquake, we started doing a lot of these microseismicity after the earthquake. And just to show you, you know, before the earthquake, these were the data that we had. You see, in this area, the upliftment is very high. I'll show you the next slide. You see here, from here to here, the mountain is rising very fast, 4.8, 2.8, and you see here, the mountain is not rising anything here, almost zero. And this was a little earlier, already pointed out by Bourgier and others, you know, team. And this is the locked period, a locked area. Now, when you have a locked area in Himalaya, what will happen? When you push something, it will go up. So that's the interpretation, a wonderful, very good, okay, this is what Pandey told after that 17 years of studies was the first real, you know, a good data set that we could see. And you see here, all these earthquakes are concentrated in this ramp. And in fact, even this ramp was really recognized, very well constrained at that time. So what happens when you have that squeezing up and then rising up? So the mountains start rising here very fast. So because it is locked here, and on this side it's slipping, so therefore what will happen is, you know, when you have a big earthquake, an earthquake, it will just, you know, subside later on, and again it will build up. So this is the mechanism that you have. Okay, that was the instrumental things that we were doing, but at the same time, we started working on the trenching for the paleoseismology. And in fact, you know, I remember in 1982-83 when I was in Japan, it was just the beginning of some few people working, and also in California. Just they started about the paleoseismology. And now, you know, it's a well-established science. And this was in 1999. We did this work, perhaps the first successful paleoseismological trenching in the Himalayas and Nepal, and we were successful to also take. And now they are more or less correlated with, 1255 historical earthquake. So this is the beginning, but now we have quite a few. Wesnowski has just summarized these things. And of course, we need many more to be more precise and for so many things, timing, segmentation, and all that. So you can see that a lot of these works have been done, and that has given us a big knowledge about the past earthquakes, because historical earthquakes, not like in Europe or China, we don't have well recording system, so therefore they are scanty, so you don't find. So to make it a history of recurrence of earthquakes, this is one of the best way to do it, and in fact it has helped us tremendously in forecasting the earthquake. Okay, now I would say the approaching Great Nepal Earthquake 20XX, maybe I'm right, maybe 20, but something like that. We cannot perhaps escape within this period of this century. It could be just tomorrow, now, after 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, but we can't escape this earthquake. So I just leveled it 20XX at the time. And we, forecasted an earthquake, but this was not really that we were expecting. We were expecting either here or here, these seismic gaps. But this happened in between, unexpectedly, and also comparatively smaller earthquake than the earthquake that we were expecting, the great earthquakes like over 8. You remember in Assam, you have an earthquake of 8.6, or you can call it 8.7 magnitude earthquake, one of the largest continental earthquakes that you find, intercontinental earthquake. So you can expect anywhere in the Himalayas similar things. And the 1505 earthquakes, we think maybe it was almost of the same size. So therefore, we are so much worried about the Western Nepal and Eastern Nepal. But why? Just again, because of the paleoseismology that we are now thinking about it. So, we had one earthquake in Eastern Nepal, you remember, 2011, Kanchenjunga earthquake. Huh? Yeah, Sikkim earthquake, we call it. And of course, in Western Nepal, many we had already. Now, you see here, these are the, So, Bilham has come out with this in 2019, that there are so many places where you have the seismic gaps. These are the ruptured areas, but you have a lot of seismic gaps. And you think, see, just in Sikkim, it should be something like 8.4 or even more. Then Everest area is still in things like this. Well, Kathmandu is now more or less, we'd say, the rupture will not there. But, people have a different concept. Now, when you say, oh, Kathmandu has done earthquakes, so we are safe for another 50 years, 100 years, 200 years. No, you have earthquakes in the east and in the west, it will equally impact the Kathmandu. It's just, Eastern Nepal earthquake will be just, 200 kilometers away or 250 kilometers away. It will destroy Kathmandu even then. So Kathmandu is never safe, whether it is in the east or in the west. If you have any great earthquakes having epicenter far away from Kathmandu, it still will be affected. It's not that you need an earthquake epicenter right in Kathmandu or near Kathmandu. So that kind of misconception we have in Nepal and also in our government people. Why we want to have the under the NAST earthquake early warning system? Because after 2015 earthquake, we started early warning system with the Chinese support, Chinese government support. But then it's not in a big way and not really systematic. So we want to do a systematic, locally initiated, local governments, money, involvement, and like that. Immediately after 2015 earthquake, some people went to the court Supreme Court, and they had this decision of the Supreme Court, but it has not been implemented by the government for the last another 7 years. So they must have two things. You must have a unified research institute on a small seismic thing, and also establish a big early warning system. Until today, nothing has been done. We know it's a basic concept that, you know, if you have an earthquake in eastern Nepal somewhere, you know, here you have Kathmandu, you'll have the stations, and you know, you all know about, you know, how it works. Just the concept. And then, if you have an earthquake somewhere here or here in Sikkim, you know, how far is Kathmandu? 285 kilometers, not far away. If it is 8.5, 8.6 magnitude scale. Remember this one, epicenter of 1934, and think of Kathmandu. 10,000 people died during that time, and now just imagine what will happen now. But there are many from here to here. I think it is something like 10 million people live in this area, apart from India I'm talking about, and there will be a big disaster in eastern Nepal if we have that. Now, why we say eastern Nepal and western Nepal? We are just thinking of now having this station in eastern Nepal is for two reasons. One is, western Nepal is very well known that, you know, now west of Gorkha to anywhere, it's a really, you know, potentially dangerous place for an earthquake, because, you know, 1505 is the last big earthquake, and after that we don't have any earthquake so far. That means it's already 500 years. So it's enough time for recurrence of great earthquakes. Though we don't know exactly the recurrence period for large earthquakes and all that, but still we expect that. But then how about the eastern Nepal and Sikkim? It is 1300 years. And in Nepal, that trenching I showed you in eastern Nepal, it is 700 years and 1300 years. So it is, in fact, much more overdue than what you have in western Nepal. I don't mean that it's not dangerous, western Nepal. Still, it is also very dangerous. And actually, we are also expecting big earthquakes in western Nepal, anywhere from western Nepal all the way, I think Dehradun or something. But then, eastern Nepal is equally, and in fact, even more serious. But less people talk about eastern Nepal. And of course, we may need more work to be done. But then still, you know, when we see Assam earthquake of 1950, 8.7 magnitude, and then nothing such a big event westward, we are scared for that. So therefore, early warning system is really, really important for Nepal. But you know, just think of the early warning system all over the world where you have this danger of earthquakes. Go to Mexico, go to USA, California, you go to Taiwan, you go to Chile, you go to Japan, of course, is a model, in fact, and then earthquake zone. They have already established these systems, and it's working very fine. And Mexico has saved millions of lives. In fact, you all know about the recent Mexico earthquake. They had the earthquake. This is a coincidence that, you know, there's no scientific evidence for that. There's no scientific reason for that. They had earthquakes, big earthquakes on the same day. You know, three times, 1985 and 2017 and this year 2022 on the same day. And on this time they were, and they have this nationally, you know, memorial day for that 1985 earthquake, and they were, having this event, and then they had siren and everything, so drill was there and everything was okay, finished, and after 1 hour there was another siren come, so people were really very, you know, confused what happened, and actually that was the earthquake. So Mexico has done a lot of savings of lives, and of course Japan or California, every country they are doing so well, and Taiwan after that search earthquake, they have done excellent work. So, unfortunately, for the last 7 years, we are sitting here without any kind of initiations of earthquake and early warning system. We need this one. And early warning system cannot be a project like, you know, you ask somebody, they bring something and they do it and they go away. It's like, you know, you have to have your own equipment, you have to have your own manpower, train them, capacity building. It has to go for another 50, 100 years. So therefore, we need really the government initiation. And so that's what I'm trying right now, going to the government. In fact, last year they gave some money, but that was not enough. So this year we are trying to have some money and then buy the equipment and start working at it. So we are just trying to do something, but still nothing is on hand right now. But then we expect that, you know, in 1 or 2 years' time, we'll establish the basic structures. And then after that, it will take another 5, 6 years. In fact, or 4 or 5 years to really, you know, to give the warnings to the public, or you know, early warning to the public for the earthquake. So because you need a lot of research in that, a lot of protocols have to be developed. Who will do it? Who will announce it? There are a lot of things. And also we have Department of Mines and Geology, who are also doing tremendous work, excellent work. They are busy with almost 40 stations and all that. At one time, all these, whatever we do with research in the beginning, has to come to one single umbrella, and you know, something like where we can save lives of people. We are so much concerned right now. If something happens in Eastern Nepal, you know, it's unimaginable. You can see 7.8 magnitude earthquake killed only 300,000 people in Haiti. 7.7 or something earthquake in Pakistan killed 80,000 people. We are not very different from there. And if that happens, if anything happens in Eastern Nepal or in Western Nepal, if anything which is over 8 magnitude, and we expect 8.2, 3, 4, 5, whatever, you know, we never know what will happen. And if that happens, and look at the population of Kathmandu, and look at the houses.
We have just 5 minutes.
Okay, and this already finished, in fact. Look at the houses that we have. 40% of the houses are like that. Even otherwise, you know, hill slopes, you know, even if you have a good house, the landslides. In Pakistan, they had nearly 25% of the people died from landslides, approximately. You know, so, and 2015 earthquake is still troubling us because it created so many thousands of landslides, and still we are struggling. So an earthquake is something like, you know, so dreadful. If you have a big earthquake, it will push the country's economy, in fact, every development work for another 20 years, 25 years. Just imagine, after 2015 earthquake, it's 7 years, but we lost almost 6, 7 years, just, you know, reconstruction. We spent so much of money. And thanks to international, you know, community that we also received, you know, good support for during and after the earthquake and reconstruction. But sometimes, you know, it may be a difficult time. You may not really receive those supports every time. So we have to be prepared internally. And early warning system saves life. There's no question. And technology is still advancing day by day, but we need really, you know, very sturdy, strong base of our research. And particularly if I think of Eastern Nepal, there are a lot of things to be done. A lot of transverse structures are there. Their mechanisms are not very well known still, you know. MHT, once you come in the western part, the MHT plays a very important role anyway, and you have a few of these transects. Transverse structures or cross-cutting structures, but Eastern Nepal is really having a lot of concentration of these things. So we need also a basic research to understand really about the earthquake mechanism there. It's not only MHT. And some of the faults go all the way from Nepal border, in Eastern Nepal border, to Bangladesh. And they have some earthquakes like that. So we don't know how much is also shared these you know, Himalayan strain along those transverse faults going all the way to Bangladesh. There are so many things that we need to do, and I also said many times earlier, you know, Nepal is a country of such, I would say, a seismically so active place. But then we have so few seismologists in Nepal, and we need to now capacity building. We don't have it through a university seismic seismology department or geophysics department. We have to start from there, but then also we need to train our students. So early warning system like this, establishing more local stations will have really, very, very long time impact on our preparedness for the future great earthquakes that we are expecting. We cannot, and last thing is, whenever we talk about earthquakes, the media, the people, they said you are scaring people. It's not scaring people and then, panicking them. It's to make them aware that, you have to be prepared. You are living in a country where, there's not a single square inch where you can stand and say, I'm safe here. There's no place at all, anywhere. So therefore, knowing your hazard is very important so that you can prepare it. So that's what I tell many times whenever I speak to common people. With this, I just close it here. Thank you for listening.
Dr. Christian from Lanoa. Dr. Lanoa is a research director at CRPG, CNRS, France. And he's the life member of Nepal Geological Society. He started his research in the Himalayas in 1983 as a PhD student with a very famous Himalayan geologist, Patrick Lapore, and his team, and he's continuously doing his research in the Himalayas.
Thank you for this nice introduction. So first I want to thank Ananda, Kaviraj, all the team for a wonderful HPHU meeting. It's really a pleasure to be here in Nepal. And I'm so glad to be able to present the research we do on the distant Himalaya and the Indian Ocean. And this work goes with many colleagues which were on the expedition of drilling expedition. Colleagues from Germany for Catch Peace, who did the whole the marine seismic reconnaissance, Tilman Schenk, Expedition 354 scientists, many Himalayan colleagues with which I've been working through years in the Himalaya, in the Gangetic Food Plain, in the Bangladesh Delta, and of course in the marine record. Before to start, I would like to pay tribute to Peter Molnar, who passed recently, and Peter has been very important for this project. He has been supportive of and really triggering Volkart Spies and myself to put together the proposal. It was co-proponent in 1999 of drilling in the Bengal Fan. And he really was a driving force in that. So, all starts in here, at the foot of the Machu Picchu. This is a picture from my PhD field work in 1983. It was a very different world then. So we have glacier erosion. I will not develop that much all the processes which are going on in Nepal or in the Himalaya. This is all well known from the audience. Glacial landslides and river incision triggered by monsoon help tremendous transfer of sediments by rivers penetrating coming from very mountainous and very dynamic rivers during the monsoon forward and reaching here in the case of the Mahanadi rivers with extreme power of transport and carrying several grams of sediments per liter over 4 months of the monsoon as a permanent flux. All these rich Bangladesh rivers that you have here and generates a flux of Himalayan matter to the Indian Ocean. So the system, the Himalayan erosion system, is a very wide one. It's probably the largest one in the, on the Earth. You have the steepest zone valleys of the planet here in the Himalaya, followed by river transport in the flattest area of the Earth, the Gangetic Plain. All this arrives in the Bengal Delta, Bangladesh Delta, sediments about 100, sorry, a billion ton of sediments are deposited annually in Bangladesh on the submarine delta or on the delta, depending of sea level changes and so on. And from there starts a completely different way of transport of sediments. Turbidites are generated from the shelf and exported in the Bengal fan on over distances of more than 3,000 kilometers. Altogether, the Bengal fan has been well mapped by Joe Curry, starting in the 80s, and he has demonstrated that the thickness of the fan can reach up to 20 kilometers just south of Bangladesh, and over the most of the lengths of the fan, it's like 3 to 10 kilometers of sediments which are accumulated there since the last 50 years. So most of the Himalaya is actually lying there, and is a fantastic source of information for us to reconstruct the past erosion of the Himalaya. Briefly showing how the sediments are exported there. So they are deposited on the shelf of the just south of Bangladesh. This is a very shallow water area, 10 meters of water altogether. And then there is this very deep canyon, about 1,000 meters deep submarine canyon with very steep slopes of typically 20 degree, and this generates turbidites which are exported downstream throughout mostly a channel levee system. These channels are meandering and have river-like morphology. They actually behave quite differently, but they build fine-grained silt over long deposit and are carrying sand towards the deep fan. Whenever a breach occurs in the levee, sand loads are deposited in the system. When you look at the fan at the large scale, this is a work by Schwenk and Spies on three long seismic profiles across the Bay of Bengal from north to south. And you can see that the fan is constructed by the stacking of those channel levees between the levees there is coarser deposition in the system. We chose for a variety of reasons to build our project of drilling at 8 degrees north at the latitude of Sri Lanka. This is because with reasonable depths of drilling you can reach neogene records, and this is also because it is in international waters, which simplifies a lot of things. And so the project has been built based on this 8 degrees north transect. So the expedition took place in 2015. You can, if you have very good eyes, you can recognize Pascal Wigg and Jan Nashman, which were on board together with me here. And we had the pleasure to have three Nepalese scientists coming as PhD from Japan and Germany, which are there in the center of the photo. This is an image of the seven-hole transect we have. Seven holes, relatively shallow, about 200 meters to recover the Pleistocene story of the fan, and three deep holes about 1,000 meters deep to recover Neogene information. And the easternmost hole here on the 19th ridge has allowed to go throughout the fan and reach the fan substratum from documenting the onset of the fan at this place in the lower Miocene. This is a typical sequence of turbidite from a levee that we recover. These are silt to clay silt to silty sand sequences of several centimeters thick. Sometimes sand is a little more abundant. There is quite a variety of these. Accumulation rates are in the range of 1 to 5 meters per kilo year at this relatively distant zone of the distant we are here in a site very distant from the delta, 1,500 kilometers. And we also have a very thick sand deposition represented in yellow on these logs, and those sands are structureless and are very difficult to drill. And so generated some lack in the recovery of those drillings. But sand was a blessing for research, of course, as it carries a lot of information. This is an example of how discontinuous is the deposition in a fan like that. This reconstruction of the levee sequence from the late Pleistocene by Bergman and collaborators shows the movement of the depot center from east to west after a longer period of no fan deposition 600,000 years ago. And around the 600,000 years ago, you can see the construction of the fan that restarted then, and the sequence of the levees. So in order to reconstruct the record from those, we have to combine information from different sites. This is the long-term image we have thanks to the three deep drillings. So the easternmost site reached 18 million years, the last turbidite we have, the earliest turbidite we have. Unfortunately, we were not recovering Oligocene sediments as we were hoping. Something which still has to be done, probably in deeper sections of the fan, but requiring a quite different way of drilling and much deeper drilling if we want to reach such a deep time record. The Neogene is, however, relatively well covered, and we have those overall quite continuous accumulation rates in the order of 10 centimeters per kilo year of turbidite for the three deep sites, to the exception of one interval of the site U1451. As I mentioned, sand was a very problematic lithology to core, but it was also a very important lithology we wanted to recover. We were lucky enough to have big samples of sand throughout the record. Altogether, recovering sand is difficult, but we can estimate the proportion of sand in the system to about 60% of the volume of the fan at 8 degrees north. The rest of the turbidites is silt, sandy silt, silty, silt and clay silt, and represents the rest of the material. We have here a comparison of gangetic sand with sand of turbidites of the Bengal fan. The lithologies the minerals are exactly the same. It's quite amazing to compare those river sands you can find here in the rivers of the Himalaya with those in the deep sea ocean. And all the classical and index metamorphic minerals like garnet, kyanite, sillimanite, etc. have been recognized in those samples throughout the record. And this is one example from the work of Yoshida on board. Thanks to the sand recovery, there has been a lot of work done on dense minerals like zircon, apatite, rutile. I will just briefly mention the work by Bloom showing that all sources of represented in the modern Ganga and Brahmaputra were represented in the fan throughout the record since the Miocene. Pascal Wigg through apatite fissure tract demonstrated rapid exhumation throughout the record, and Yanni has been doing a very detailed work to track extreme exhumation rates and onset of the Nanchenawa erosion or input, dating it around 3 to 4 million years. Jérôme Labbé yesterday already presented this record of erosion rates deciphered from quartz. This is probably the first time we can do beryllium 10 on a marine record over such a long time record. And this is showing that throughout the Upper Miocene to present, we have erosion. Mean erosion rate, very integrated erosion rate, which appears relatively constant around 0.7 to 1 millimeter per year, integrated for the whole basin indeed, and that resembles very well what we can measure today. Some other, very rapidly, other results we can decipher from those fan records. Here, this is the work by Sarah Fickens and Valier Galli, who are actually discussing in Pokhara during the post-COS meeting. And they have been looking at isotopic composition of hydrogen and carbon of plant wax, documenting paleo precipitation with very negative compositions, indicative or characteristics of the monsoon intensity. Throughout the record, demonstrating quite likely that monsoon was already established with a very intense regime, a very seasonal regime 18 million years ago, and has been such throughout the record. Delta C13 is also showing the well-known C4 plant expansion in the Upper Miocene, documenting the switch of vegetation in the floodplain towards savanna types of vegetation. So I will now present more results on the sediment provenance. This is a strontium neodymium isotopic composition of Bengal fan sediments. The color scale is age of deposition. And you can see there is a slight change in the mixing relationship of strontium and neodymium in this plot. But overall, we have a relatively homogeneous composition of the fan. Other information comes from carbonates. When you look at the fan sediments, the turbidite sediments, they carry a lot of carbonates. A little part of it is biogenic carbonates due to the marine activity, of course, but it's very scarce. Most of the carbonates are carbonates inherited from Himalayan rivers. And you can see that the abundance of those carbonates is quite high. The total carbonate can reach sometimes 15% or 8% of the sediment. This is well known that Himalayan rivers, and particularly the Ganga, carries carbonate, detrital carbonate in its bed load. They mostly come from the Narayani River, where the erosion of the Annapurna and Duragiri branch generates a lot of carbonates and allows the saturation of the rivers with respect to carbonates. Downstream, those carbonates are dissolved and altogether at the end of the present day river system, we have about 3% of carbonates in the bedrock of the or sediment load of the lower Meghna as of today. This is linked to the intensity of the water. The more water you have with respect to sediment, the less saturated you are, and the more you lose carbonates. It is also strongly controlled by the geological occurrence of carbonates in the basin. And you can see here, when you compare the Kosi basin and the Nahari basin, the difference in the amount of carbonates. In the Kosi, you have very little carbonates, dominated by dolomite from the Lesser Himalaya, whereas the Nahari is strongly dominated by the Annapurna-Duragiri branch. Isotopic composition of those carbonates allows us to actually decipher the relative proportion of the different sources. Okay, I go fast. And so the amount of the triton carbonate has been varying through time, and we can show that this is linked to changes in the occurrence or of Tethys Himalaya in the system. So it is possible that during the Miocene, when the triton carbonate proportion was very high, we had a situation in the Himalaya comparable to that of the local exposure of Tethys Himalaya in the system, whereas nowadays most of the river system is with one where the HHC or the Greater Himalaya is exposed in the high range. This can be challenged by chemical erosion, and we have to look at chemical erosion at the same time. We have here a study looking at chemical composition of silicates of those sediments. Here, sodium and calcium, which are dominated by plagioclase, and we can see roughly that plagioclase concentration decreases through time, so there was less plagioclase in the past. This is partly controlled, I will go very fast, by the source composition and sediment sorting, but taking into account all these parameters, we can demonstrate that there was much more chemical weathering in the past, in the Miocene, than in the present. So there is a change in the basin throughout time in terms of weathering, which actually rules out the hypothesis that the change in carbonate concentration could be linked to weathering. Other information comes from isotopic composition of carbonates or for strontium or silicates for neodymium, showing that probably the onset of more intense exposure of the Lesser Himalaya occurred between 8 and 6 million years in the system. We have appearance of radiogenic carbonates, which are typical from the Lesser Himalaya. We established that we have a drainage of the Trans-Himalaya established since the Lower Miocene, whether or not it is by the present-day Tsongpo, Siang, Brahmaputra network or another one in the past is still debatable, but material from the Trans-Himalaya is feeding the Bengal Fan since this period. We had a higher exposure of the Tethys Himalaya during the Miocene, so a system probably like this one, dominated by rocks from the HHC and the Tethys Himalaya, with contribution of the Trans-Himalaya in the past. Whereas since the later Miocene and Pliocene, we have the introduction of Lesser Himalayan erosion, of course. The weathering approach is quite important as it documents or it relates to changes in the environment of the basin, probably linked to changes in paleogeography of the basins. During Miocene times, the floodplain area was much much wider, especially for the Brahmaputra. The Brahmaputra was not channelized as it is today in Assam, and probably leading to much more weathering than at present. So with this, I will leave you with this thoughts, and I thank you for your attention. I just want to advertise a recent article by Peter Clift and a lot of colleagues relating a synthesis of all drillings realized over the last 10 years around the Asia-Tibet Himalaya system, which has been quite a strong investment of the scientific community to try to better understand the monsoon system and the erosion and the climate tectonic interactions. Thank you very much for that.
So it is almost coinciding with the more or less the continental side. Here we have 16 billion years in Shivalik in Karnali, and in Pakistan I think they are slightly older, so they almost coincide, right?
Yeah. However, this is probably conjectural. The site we have been drilling is a, because we wanted to go throughout the whole fan, we chose a site where it was feasible in terms of drilling, depths of drilling. And so we went on the side of the 90th ridge, which is a tectonic feature which is continuously deforming throughout the system. Maybe I can go back. Yeah. This here, this video. So this is this site here. And this is lying on the 90th ridge. This is deforming. So it, for most of the Oligocene, it was certainly not. It was certainly too high to be hit by deposition of the fan. So what we see, what we date, is the onset of fan deposition at this location. If we had the way to drill a 4 kilometer deep hole here, we would reach probably Oligocene fan sedimentation, and Yabi would be something.
Time to appreciate our presenters and sincere, co-chair and rapporteurs. I request participants need to wait few minutes to appreciate our renowned keynote speakers.
To be here again, I want to welcome you all. Nepal Mountain Academy has been organizing one session. It is international conference that we are planning to organize. So I have presented here in presentation Global Mountain and Mountain, Global Mountain Science and Mountaineering Conference in 2023 November. It is a great opportunity to have these experts in Nepal about the mountain science. Three components of different thematic areas has been covered in this, will be covered in this conference. So you all experts, dignitaries are invited here from. We are going to circulate you with the details, thematic areas. I want to go next slide, please. With the with detailed thematic areas that we are going to cover in our seminar, this mountaineering, mountain meteorology, mountain resource, mountain hazards, mountain environment. Next, please. Mountain people and livelihood, mountain ecology, mountain geography, mountain geology, adventure tourism, multiple disciplinary thematic areas have been covered in our concept. But still we are in the planning process for the detailed project, the detailed plan workout. And for us, we are getting support from Nepal Geological Society, Tirchandra College, IOST. ISTTU and PRISUB University Slovakia and Montana State University has been supporting us for this program. So I would like to welcome you all in 2023 November. Thank you very much for this waiting, listening to me. I'm sorry I took your time at the end. Thank you.
Similarly, I request Professor Dr. Vishal Nath Upredi.
Member National Planning Commission to come to the dais. To do the co-chair, Honorable Dr. Juddha Bahadur Gurung, please come to the dais. And then for the rapporteur, we have Neeraj Singh Thakuri. He is the head of Department of Geology, Birendra Multiple Campus, Chittagong. And similarly, I would like to request the presenter to come to the front seat, Kaviraj Powdel, Ram Bahadur Shah, Sunil Lamsal, Dhruva Kondel, and colleagues, Sivakumar Baskota, Namraj Neopane, Truna Bahadur Ali. Thank you once again, and now I would like to request Dr. Rampur Kriyam to give the opening remarks.
It's my honor and privilege to be a part of this very important evening today. I'm much delighted to meet you all in this summit. Now we are conducting a session related to research presentations prepared by highly esteemed scholars of the university and government employees. They are basically based on the Nepal's case studies and R&D of the Nepal of mine and mineral sectors. Hope you'll enjoy the presentation, and the paper presenters, please, you follow the instruction as it was already given to you about your time frame, and also be strict on what special area of your research interest you have contributed your knowledge, and how this knowledge can be implemented for nation building agenda, and what is your main contribution for ongoing and future research. Speak on your presentations only on 2-3 things: research questions, methods you have applied undertaking your research, data, lab result, and significance of your result for policy building. Thank you. I would like to request Kaviraj Powdel to give the presentation.
The title of my presentation today in this morning is The Metallic Mineral Resources in Nepal, Himalaya, Key for the Prosperity of People and Sustainable Development of Nepal. Anyway, the status of mineral resources, actually the metallic mineral resources. Carry out these presentations, there is a contribution of Professor Ram Bahadur Shah with here, so I request to give him stand and thank you. And there are other so many researchers, especially my students, PhD scholars, and many young researchers. Yeah, once a time we had a king, and his concept was to promote the mineral resources of the country, and according to him, shift the villages and run the mine if there exist economic deposits of the minerals. He was Prithvi Narayan Shah, king of Shah, and who unified Nepal. And during his time, still we have many traces of the exploitation of mineral resources in the country. And this is the generalized geological map of Nepal. And here clearly we can see four
broad tectonic units starting from the sub-Himalaya. This is also called Surya Range, Surya Range in Nepal, and Shivaliks as well. And then the Lesser Himalaya, since Lesser Himalaya occupies very larger area in Nepal Himalaya. And then followed northward the higher Himalaya and then the parts of the Teshi rock succession. There is kyanite and garnet and tourmaline, aquamarine, beryl and rock crystals, ruby and sapphire deposits are reported from the several parts of our territory. And similarly, we have dimension stones, marble. We have two types of marble. One is general marble and another it could be green marble, because we have very good quality metabasic rocks. This we call amphibolite. And if this amphibolite give the reflections, then we can use them as a green marble. And next is slate, roofing slate, and some schist, which are used for paving, cladding, facing like this. And similarly, granite marble and green marble is, and some, yes, our territory is very potential for construction materials. Not only the riverside construction materials, but also we have the hard rocks, very good rocks, and we can extract them even from the bedrocks. These major types of mineral deposits, we have some sedimentary deposits because there is indication of mineralization during the diagenesis of the rock. Such type of sedimentary mineral deposits and hydrothermal deposits, magmatic deposits, and some minerals are structurally controlled deposits, and some are metamorphic deposits and others are placer deposits. And this is the location of potential mineral resources of Nepal in the map of Nepal. And we can see, look here, the most of the minerals so far we have identified are concentrated at the middle central portion of the country. This represents the Lesser Himalaya. So our mineral resources mostly are really concentrated to the central part. This is the question. I think, yeah, mineral resources are also, there is possibility of concentration of mineral resources even other parts of the Nepal, but prospecting and study is not carried out in the remote areas like in Higher Himalaya and Tethys Zone. Similarly, in case of the Shivalik range, there is less possibilities of metallic minerals, but we have very good construction materials, rock for construction materials, and you know, uranium are also reported from the rocks of the Shivalik. And this is the location of mineral resources in geological map of Nepal, and mostly the metallic minerals are seen in the rocks of the Lesser Himalaya. And in our Lesser Himalaya, we can find two or three types of rock successions. One is autochthonous rocks, another is allochthonous rocks. That rocks are positioned by thrusting from the north to the south. And they have occupied at the larger synclinarium structures. And other types of rocks are also sedimentary type of rocks equivalent to Gondwana rocks. And another is Precambrian rocks, and other is the allochthonous types of rocks, and its age is also determined as the Precambrian. And these, most of the metallic minerals are located in the Lesser Himalayan part of the nation. Lead and zinc, this lead and zinc are found in the Himal group. Its another name is Higher Himalaya Formation Second. There is this is the Calcanized Succession, Kathmandu Nap Succession, Marco Formation within this succession. And iron is geologically found within the Norpul Formation. It is considered a Precambrian succession. And Vaisikati Formation, this is supposed to be tertiary. And this our famous Bhawari Iron prospect is supposed to be continuation of these deposits. And another, we have Bhimpheri group, and some traces of iron
are also found within this group. And copper, mostly copper is shown within the rocks of Kuncha formation and Norpool formation and in the rocks of naps of the Kathmandu and Jagarkot naps, and these are supposed to be precambrian. Iron, we have ores of hematite and magnetite, basically two types of broadly, yes, we have limonite deposits as well. And important iron deposits are two types and are stratigraphically controlled. We have one famous Laptikola and Bhutkola area within the Kuncha formation, and we have reported good deposits of iron in the Laptikola and Bhutkola area. And similarly, there is Phose and Jelvan, and the host rock is porzite, schist, and phyllite of the Bhimpedi group. So this succession could be the potential site for iron deposits even in other parts of Nepal. Similarly, we have some sedimentary deposits like Phulchoki, Chitlang formation. There it is of considered as Silurian age, and Bhaisikati formation. There is some deposits of magnetite and hematite, basically hematite. These are the geological control of such mineralization. If we see these lofty deposits within the Norpool formation, this is sedimentary in nature. There is an intercalation of the rocks and iron deposits. So it clearly shows that it is sedimentary in nature, not other processes. But in case of copper mineralization, this copper is not sedimentary, it is epigenetic. Means the source of copper mineralization can be seen in metallic rock. Jelvan iron mineralization, this is the outcrop of iron, and similarly, there are other several locations. This Fulibang iron mineralization in Rolpa district. Some of our students, we hoped to prospect the iron from Rolpa, and we have found several locations rich for iron mineralization. And these iron mineralization is found within the rocks of the Bhimpedi group, equivalent to Bhimpedi group. These are actually considered the thrust lying within the Lesser Himalaya. Yes, this is another outcrop of Fulibang iron mineralization. Look here, these are the columnar sections showing the position of iron mineralization in this area, and it shows that the iron is bedded type, iron deposit is bedded type, it is parallel to, sub-parallel with the rock successions. Yes, these are some of the outcrops, photographs of this iron mineralization in Rukum and Rolpa area, which lies western part of Nepal. It is western from Kathmandu, even western part from Pokhara. Okay, this is the sum of the lead and zinc deposits. These are the locations indicated by red color, and this is these locations are taken from the departments of mines and geology, and Ischia, and Sharma, and many more. Okay, these are the mineralization of copper in Rolpa. We have prepared a map showing the copper deposits, and these are the outcrops of copper mineralization. And copper mineralization in Phailbang, Rolpa, this is also very famous place for the copper mineralization. In the past, in ancient time, there was a hoax of copper exploitation. We have several such indications of copper mining. And copper mineralization in Fulibang, Rolpa, this is the host rock is quartzite and schist. Look here, this is host rock is quartzite and schist again at the Ranjimpur of Rolpa. And similarly,
This is the metallic mineralization in Gulmi area. Look here in this outcrop, you can see the polymetallic deposit. And there is azurite and malachite and polymetallic deposits, and especially the copper deposits in addition to nickel and cobalt. Recently we have tested and found the concentration of nickel and cobalt. So we have such a deposit within this area, and we have documented, we have found this deposit, a good deposit in bedrock. And this is the police section, and from police section we can see the mineral assemblages of copper and nickel. And the later Darwin prospect, this is the geological control of this nickel, cobalt and copper, is also found from the equivalent to the Bimberi group. And these are some of the field photographs that we encounter such polymetallic deposits. Some traces of silver are also reported from the bedrock, from this bedrock. In Neta, this lies near the junction of Gulmi and Bagun district. And Baithum copper deposit, next here we have several traces of copper in this area. And this is the columnar section, this shows that there is the epigenetic deposits of copper, not syngenetic. This is supposed to be controlled by hydrothermal activity. And this is also the copper deposits. We prepared the map, and regarding the gold, the gold in bedrock is reported only from the roll path, Lundi Gola section and adjacent areas. And we have taken the sample and tested, even in the, from Central Department of Geology. This was already reported by departments of Mines and Geology as well. And we have lots of opportunity to find the gold deposits even in the terrestrial deposits. And the result and conclusion, most of the geological control for metallic minerals is linked with igneous processes, with few the stratigraphic in nature. The copper mineralization in Nepal was genetically found to be linked with basic igneous rocks. Wherever we find the copper, and immediate below, stratigraphically downward, we have documented the metabasic rocks. So this could be the source for copper mineralization. And recently, good mineralization of nickel and cobalt is found in Gulmi district in western Nepal. And further exploration is necessary. This is our recommendation. And the genesis of mineralization is hydrothermal in nature. These minerals are already documented as strategic mineral by USA and China. And we could have the good opportunity to develop nickel and cobalt in our country. They are either genetically or epigenetically confined to particular stratigraphic units. These deposits are related in time and space to certain events of crustal movement, igneous activities, metamorphism, and others, which is in broader sense includes the subject of stratigraphy. And in case of province 4, finally, Young City zone is very near from here in the northward side. Korua village is very famous for it, where we have trace out the position of Young City. Here we have found the very good crystals of garnet and kyanite. So this area could be the very good site for such semi-precious stones. Thank you.
So let's have a look on the history of cement. As all of us know that our from old buildings like Singha Darbar and Bag Darbar were built using Vajra plaster, which is a mixture of a lime, sand and shurki, which is brick powder. There was the Persic period from 1950 to 1971 where at first the Industrial Enterprise Act was formulated and Feasibility Study Committee recommended to establish Himal Cement Company for the country. In commencement period from 1972 to 1984, Himal cement industry, the first and foremost cement industry in Nepal, was established. And after 1985, there was a traction period where two more industries were established, the Udaipur cement industry in 1987, and then later on, Hetauda cement factory in 1976. Again, industrial policy 1992 was formulated, similarly for investment and technology transfer act. Was enacted in 1992, and private sectors were encouraged to invest in the cement industry, and the first cement industries were established in 1996, almost at the same time with Kutal cement mills, Lumini cement, and the National cement. After that, from 2004, there was some political chaos in the country, and that was the transition period up to 2010. And in the meantime, Nepal has entered into WTO in 2004, and within this period, 35 private cement industries were granted permission. And after 2011 up to now, the industrial policy 2001 was formulated, and now, at present, the nation is in the verge of self-reliance in cement manufacturing. So, on the graph in the right shows the periods of development of cement industry. So, at present, there are 124 cement industries registered in the Department of Industry, and 63 of them are in operation, out of which 14 are integrated units. 38 are grinding units only, and some of them are vertical shaft mills, which is being outdated technology now. And our cement production capacity is 10.2 million tons. Please note that this data is about more 1.5 years old, and it may have risen up some. And 17 million tons of cement grinding. In this, the 6.8 million tons is contributed by grinding units. And the capacity of utilization of cement factories has reached up to 70%. I want to stress here that the cement factories which are established within the country are not operated in the full scale due to various reasons, including the availability of a market. So now it has been reached up to 70%. So this is a table which shows the demand versus supply gap and projected growth in the cement industry. Let us see at the last. Up to 2024, the demand will be about 16.9 million tons. The installed capacity is already more than the demand, and we are in a surplus production. If we produce at the 100% or even 92% of utilization, achieving a growth rate of 15% at that time. So this is the geographical distribution of present cement industry throughout the country. Note that most of the cement industries are located in the Tarai region due to availability of land, due to accessibility of infrastructures like road and others. Mostly limestone is available in Nepal, and other raw materials is required for cement production are to be imported. Except few which are in the hilly regions, few of them are in hilly region, most of them are distributed in the Tarai region. So now let's discuss about the raw materials, what are required for cement production. Most of all us know what is required. The major raw material is the limestone, which is consumed about 60 to 70%, and the next major one is silicon oxide or simply sand, and then aluminium oxide or alumina. And iron oxide, manganese oxide is generally included within the limestone, and iron oxide or hematite ore up to 6%. And it is mixed here, and gypsum, which is mixed after production of the clinker. So, now let us discuss about the limestone, which is the major raw material for cement. As we know, it is consumed up to 70% of in the total raw material for cement production. And the general assumption for cement production is that calcium oxide must be at least 42%, and magnesium oxide must not be greater than 3%. And cement grade limestone being abundant in Nepal, it has led cement industry to be lucrative for investors. And we know that many FDIs are also being attracted in the country for cement production. So, talking about the geological distribution of carbonate rocks, mostly there are abundance of limestone or simply carbonate rocks in Lesser Himalayan terrain, as we saw in our previous presentation as well. And so some of them are distributed to higher Himalaya also, but these are only calc silicates simply. And some of them are in a Tibetan Tethys zone as well, which has not been explored much detail for cement products. So up to now, we have mapped about 7,000 square kilometer of the surface area being occupied by limestone throughout the country. So being more specific, let us see the distribution of limestone throughout the country. Here we can see two colors, the dark gray color represents siliceous limestone, high magnesia limestone, or simply calc silicate rocks. And the blue one is for cement grade limestone. This map is prepared based on the data which is generated by independent investors in cement industries, as well as research from Department of Science and Geology. So it is not complete in the sense that many investors who have invested in cement industries may not have explored in their exploration area in the full stage, and Department of Mines and Geology also has not completed the investigation throughout the country. As I have mentioned earlier, that in the Tibetan Tethys zone, we have not studied limestone prospect for the cement manufacturing buildings. So up to now, we have 985 million tons of limestone with 139 million tons of proved reserves. So this is distribution of the mining sites throughout the country. Mainly there is distribution in Lesser Himalayan terrain. And regarding the composition of limestone is not similar throughout the country. Based on few, nearly 102,000 analysis results from Department of Mines and Geology from 9 districts, I have presented here the distribution of chemical composition. The top blue line represents for calcium oxide percentage, and lower yellow line for magnesium oxide. So these are the distribution of exploration licenses throughout the country. At present, there are 87 opening licenses and 240 prospecting licenses issued by Department of Mines and Geology for limestone. So this is demand analysis. By 2040, we may require 34 million ton per annum limestone to maintain the requirement of country. This is the production revenue at present. So there is 14.05 million ton of production in 2078-79, and there is 7.86 billion of the revenue raised from limestone only. The revenue from cement is not included over here. So this is the clinker import trend. I have mentioned earlier that clinker import is being substituted now completely. So a balance between development and environment is quite inevitable. So the current challenge is how to boost the consumption. As we are already in surplus production, we have to think about the new consumption trends in the country. Now we are in this stage of a shakeout, and now we are towards maturity and decline phase remaining. So now may I conclude my statement now? There are 124 cement industries registered in Nepal and 63 are in operation, I have mentioned earlier, and 10.2 million tons of capacity is installed, and they are running at 70% of their capacity at this time. And around 7,000 square kilometers of area of the country is covered by limestone. Most of them are high magnesia, and some are really of good quality. And about 149 million ton has been already proved category. And with increasing cement production, Nepal is struggling to balance the nature and industry. And the current status of cement industry is grounded on decades. I want to stress this. Long painstaking efforts by geologists, mining engineers, policymakers, and investors. So, mining industry demands long-term research, investments, and tons of patience. So, this is an example of limestone, and there are many other mineral-based industries which need a long-term resource investment to answer questions, and the government policy must support mineral-based industries. Thank you. Relating to the stratigraphy, the good quality limestone, cement grade limestone, or even chemical grade limestone belongs to the Beni Ghat slates of lower, upper Nuwakot group. And there is one famous Jigu carbonate member, which is really thin, up to few hundreds of meters thick at places, and it pinches out quite irregularly towards its strike extension. And this, in fact, is being used as sweetener purpose, as it has calcium oxide greater than 52% and a negligible amount of magnesium oxide. And the next one unit is Poinsettavan marble, which belongs to the Kathmandu complex, Bhimpheri group. And it has some high magnesium oxide as well as silica, which is being blended with the previous one to manufacture cement. The next one is Marfu formation, which consists of metamorphosed limestone marble, and it has also similar characteristics with that of Poinsettavan marble, and it has just a marginal quality for cement production, and cement plants or say quarries of limestone are based on the Punchoki group rocks like Chandragiri limestone and Godavari limestone around the periphery of Kathmandu Valley. And I told you earlier that in Tethian affinity there are many limestone fractures which are not explored from the point of view of cement manufacturing.
Thank you, Pasukita. Maybe we'll talk more on lunch time. So another question.
I would like to request Purna Bahadur Ali to give a presentation.
See, I observed the presentation about the geological investigation, geological prospecting. Now I am presenting here some different type of presentation. What is the status? This is not a research-based presentation. This is mainly the status sharing and knowledge sharing, and I am focusing only in the water resource of Nepal and knowledge contribution in the water resource by the geoscience and geologist in Nepal. So I am focusing only that portion, and I think this is only being the international workshop and our reputed guest from different country, I want to say some water resource status of Nepal also here, only in brief, and I will mention some other things here. This is the water resource in Nepal. Surface water, 225 BCM surface water is available per year. Nepal, and only less than 10% is used so far, and 600 rivers and rivulets in our country is available, and groundwater about 12 BCM groundwater mainly in Tarai region, which is the 17% of the country lies in Tarai region. It is 12 BCM and 17,000 MCM groundwater in the mountain region. This is the water resource of Nepal. And potentiality about what is the potentiality of the water resource? Hydropower gross, till the study, today's gross potential is 83,500 megawatt of the gross potential, and economically viable, as we accepted till now, is 25,630 megawatt, and till now we have only developed about 5% of the economically viable hydropower and irrigation out of the 3 million hectare agriculture land, 2.26 million hectare is irrigable land, and we have developed only 1.5 million hectare irrigation infrastructure in Nepal. And water supply, drinking water supply, we have plenty of potential, and there is possibility of 100% drinking water supply to the people of Nepal, and we are achieving the 100%, not very near to the achieving the 100% drinking water supply. And navigation boat is the application, use of the water resource in the river, both not only in internal and binational. With India, we are trying to the navigation to the with India. And I want to mention the water resource development. There are so many, this is multi-professional wings of the development, and in water resource development, civil engineer, there are so many discipline of civil engineer, geotech engineer, structural engineer, design engineer, hydrologist engineer, irrigation engineer, hydropower engineer, and other engineer, electrical, mechanical, agriculture engineer are working in the water resource development. And geologist, mainly geologist, and there are some specialist geologists, hydrogeologist, engineering geologist, geophysicist, geochemist, seismologist, and others. This is the multi-professional wing, so environment specialist, economist, sociologist, financial specialist, agronomist, and so many professionals are working in the water resource. And in water resource development, there are so many government and non-government organizations working there. Main government organization is Ministry of Energy, Water Resource and Irrigation, and so many other sister organizations. And what Ministry of Water Supply is looking for the drinking water and sanitation, and other different IPPs are working well in the hydropower development of Nepal. Now more than 50% hydropower is developed by the IPPs in Nepal, and many NGOs, INGOs are working well in the drinking water and some research in the water resource development. And as I mentioned, in geologists are working in the water resource development from the field level geologist to the joint secretary level in the government, and in the private sector from the field level geologist to the project manager level in the private sector. There are so many application of water resource in hydropower development, GON and GON entity. There are so many I have already mentioned. But I want to mention one thing, that after federation of the government, local government is using applied the water resource, but there is no relevant geoscience scientist and geological knowledge in the local level, and also there is not sufficient for this structure is not also sufficient geoscience and geologist in the, that organization. I want to mention only that thing. And this is the our organization working in the water resource development in Nepal. And there are some geological input, geoscience input, and geotechnical input are being applied, are being used in Nepal. I mentioned some of the points here, and being the developed, and some research we have applied more than this technique and technology in the water resource development. Thus, from pre-feasibility to PPR level, and also design and construction level, we have done the geological, geomorphological, and engineering geological mapping in different scale as per required and as per necessary. And geological models prepared based on geological mapping. Groundwater condition check, survey groundwater conditions, survey not only the water resource development, hydropower, and but also in other situation, the groundwater condition survey is important, and discontinuity survey, rock mass classification, these are which we are using in Nepal, and geotechnical investigation, geophysical survey, exploration, core drilling, SPT and permeability, lucent test.
Yeah.
And these are some working in here. And groundwater resource, in the groundwater resource is lies in the Tarai region, and where use the groundwater resource mainly in the irrigation and drinking water. Now, this use, we have planned to all irrigable land, year-round irrigation is possible with the use of groundwater. Research paper on the landslide, we have found, and this is applied in the water resource, induced water, induced disaster management here. Thank you. And the game changer project in water resource, Kulikhani Hydropower project, which is the first reservoir project, and Melamchi is the drinking water supply, and Upper Tamakusi, Beribabai. In these two projects, which is the interbasin water transfer project, and being we have used the TBM machine for the long, 12 meter, kilometer long tunnel, and Sunkosi Marine Diversion, and Budi Gandaki Reservoir project, and Kosi Idam and Panchasar Multiple project are the binational project. These are only few of the game changer project in water resource. And this issue is very necessary to mention here in this, this important. So, and nature of books and curriculum of university in Nepal is some gaps. So it is difficult to have the good knowledge of the geologist production from the university. And other main issue is the there is no code of conduct, and geologists are not being the member of engineering geological council, or there is no the geological council separate. This is one of the issues. And geological mapping, which is the main base of the maps prepared by the DMG, is some very difficult to develop for the water resource development. It has to be updated, and the need to have the more large scale. I have 1 minute, please. And these are the some issues in the water resource development, and this is a challenge. Code of conduct is very necessary. Water resource. Now, Nepal has need to have more water resource project, and knowledge of geoscience and geology is very important, and federal system role of the geoscience is important in the federal and some. And this technology, and lastly, I want to mention that recommendation of geological map for the large project, that we have some team, some expert group in the team for the approval of the environment study report, but there is no any scientific group or some recommendation group for the recommendation to accept the geological map in the large project. It is very, I think it is important, so that there is easy to have the good. There is some problem in variation of the contact and time gap of the project completion. These are the some problem. This is only my status sharing and the use of geoscience in Nepal.
I would like to congratulate the scholar who presented a very nice paper. They were really very much
insightful and informative papers related to the current situations and status of the minerals and mine resources of the Nepal. The first and the third papers was related to the metallic resources, especially of Nepal, including the Gandaki province, in which Dr. Powell elaborated its total potentialities, capacity, and its existing status, and the future prospect for utilizing it for the benefit of the country. Actually, we have not been able to extract our huge potential resources. Due to that, we have been suffering from the trade deficits in which the metallic products and services, related goods and services to be imported to our country ranks to second and third. And it uses a huge resources of ours in terms of the foreign currencies that always makes us a problem of the capital account deficit. So we, the government, are very serious, and we have drafted periodic plan to be completely implemented in within the 5 years. And basically, at the very first 2 years now, we have been commercially utilizing the iron of the body. And similarly, we are also working with making the substitutions of petroleum oil of our Thailex mines. And there are so many others. They are strategically very potential and important for the nation building works, and we have given a high priority for their reservation, storage, excursions, and even for the protection. So I'm very much thankful to the entire team of Dr. Powell and ETL for producing such a great paper. Please try to list it up on what particular areas of prosperity that paper can contribute to make a new policy in these areas. I just would suggest this for the first and the third papers. It was really wonderful. When I moved towards the second paper, it was also really, really an important paper for us. We actually import in the past decades, we imported the cement a lot. And still, we are importing the asphalt for building the roads we call the Alapatra. It's also a huge cost of ours. And while building roads and bridges in Nepal, basically we use them. But now we have been doing a new practice to utilize our cement, RCC, and different methods of constructing the roads in Tarai and Hilly regions. They are being found very prominent and examples for the South Asia as well. If we can see the road of Sindhuli, Bardibas, Manipa, Bardibas, or some other roads are also in experimentation of using those cement for a kind of RCC road. So first, we are now going to be able to be self-dependent on cement, so reducing our imported cost. And we are also working to sort out the demand-supply ratios and its potentiality of the production in future. Even it was clearly mentioned in the paper that 10.2 million tons is its current capacity, and even 70% of that has been properly capacitated and used by the industries. So hopefully in future, we will going to promote all those 124 industries listed or registered, and we can also supply our very quality, high quality clinkers through high quality clinkers related the cement to the neighboring countries and abroad as well. So it was really a wonderful paper. Thank you, Mr. Paskota. You are in the government system also. and you know better than I do in this area, but we are benefited and we can use this in policy drafting process as well. The fourth paper, very really wonderful, as we know all that we are very rich in water resources, especially in comparing with the potentiality of producing or generating the hydro power generations, as he spoke, and we also have been reading it since so long that we have capacity of 53,500 megawatts of producing the electricity. Still, it is our own luck why we have not been able to produce more, but at least we have now been able to use the electricity 24 hours a day, and all of our e-governance related services and all the activities, they are to be conducted by the government or private sector or households or everyone, has become so easy since last 5 years. Even though the production is very low, but we have used a very good management. Through that best management practice on supply chains, there is no crisis on demand and supply, even if we have low production. But there is huge potentiality of producing it. And the first and foremost imported goods in which we spend nearly 2.3 million around, 2 billions US dollar rounds in petroleum wells. This electricity production can definitely substitute our that imported goods. Yes, we have a motto of import substitutions and export trade promotions for the prosperous Nepal is our motto in the trading policy. So it can be supported through this through the proper utilization of these resources. Next one, irrigation. As we all know that we imported huge amount of commodities. Delhi use goods and services especially related to our kitchens, our fooding, that can be produced through the proper utilization of irrigations in Nepal's potential land for the agriculture production. And water supply, everyone now needs and wants the water produced by Himalaya, Mount Everest. Why don't we start producing bottled waters of Himalaya and exporting to the Gulf countries or throughout the world? People want the water from Himalaya. So there is so much potentiality of this. So combining these all three papers, I got to know that the scholar and the prominent researchers contributed a lot for national building works, providing your ideas and knowledge. But somehow, scientific research is a kind of a systematic investigation process. It is a study of materials, resources, and the objects in order to establish a fact to reach into a new conclusion. And it should be disseminated in some valid forum, recognized society, or national or international SSCI, or Scopus Index, or Thomson Reuters related journals. So I would prefer, I recommend the scholar to contribute your papers, not only for many policy perspectives, maybe you are academicians, you can also enhance your knowledge, ideas by contributing to the journals of international standards that will be more valuable future for your own and for the nation as well. So I have a short remarks on your presentation, that my remarks. And as I am a member of National Planning Commission and one of the representatives of the government, I do have some responsibilities. We are restricted and bounded under a very limited time frame in according to your time schedule. So just few listed points I would like to talk on related to your entire the conferences. Please allow me to speak. Dear distinguished guests, delegates, high-level government officials, university professors, international communities members, and all high-level participants. Very good morning once again. I'm really happy, and I'm also one of the students of mathematics, and now I diverted the area of my research interest on industrial economics, planning, and especially I work on the game theory modeling. But now I happen to be a planning commission's members. So once we got appointment, then we thought of transforming this country into a prosperous country. And we made two big building blocks to transform Nepal into a prosperous country. One was we thought Nepal would be rich first economically, then only the social well-being is possible by dividing that economic asset or capital to all the peoples on the spirit of our equity and justice as our common agenda, which has been envisioned in our latest constitutions. So prosperity and social well-being can be achieved through economic and social transformations of the available resources that we have had in Nepal. So now in the economic transformations related agendas, as we always talk about owning high level of growth rate, so we focus more on building a human capital, human resources. We focus more on building human resources. So we invested a lot, nearly 13% of our national budget on social protection related schemes in order to make people secure, protected, insured from all types of risks, vulnerabilities, and pandemics. And also we have the provision of allocating about 20% of the budget for education related activities, and that we have been doing, but due to a huge pandemic which we had suffered, we were able to allocate only 11% and 12%, but also that has been work alert. And out of that, we basically focus more on learning teaching, and that learning teaching should be related to R&D innovations. So even if we had very less budget on innovation and R&D, but we wanted it to be spent for result-oriented, evidence-based that R&D. Data, experiment, whether it is of the academic research or policy research or fundamental research or basic research, or it is experimental research, no matters, but it should be a result-oriented one. It should not be done just to keep for the cupboard or just to keep our printed documents as an inventory in the library. We want it to be used for the transformation of the nation, and we are in practice, and all our higher education related institutions are working for that. And we, from the government of Nepal, would humbly like to invite you to cooperate us, to join with us, either through student or research or institutions activities exchange program, or through different collaborative or partnership programs to gain each other from our indigenous and STEAM knowledge that we have been earning or you have already earned. So this is our request. And next one, using that very potential human resources. We can promote our production and productivity of entire sectors. And then we also emphasis on connectivity and road transportations vertically and horizontally. It's a bottom to up, up to down and horizontally. So we have initiated it a lot, and our use more than 60% of the budget goes for the budget of development expenditure goes for the construction of buildings, tunnels, roads, bridges, many more things are there. And so far we are now focusing more on agriculture production, and we hope it will enhance our national productivity, GDP, national income, and definitely our per capita income will be increased. And our target to achieve the per capita income is $1,595 in next 2 years. Hopefully we can earn it, because now even if we had that much huge problem of the pandemic, our per capita income is $1,381 as compared to 7 years back, it has nearly been doubled. So we can do it. And in next 20 years, we reached into high income country. It's our aim, it is our ambition. And in next 8 years, we have to fulfill all those SDGs goals. And in next 4 years, we will graduate from least developed countries to developing countries. So all those infrastructure have been built, datas have been produced, and some disaggregated datas are also on the way to produce. So we are linked with the international communities, and you know well that we have geopolitical realities is quite in a problematic mode, but still with a balance policy between North and South that we have applied, so far we are in a prosperous way to enhance our, all those development activities. So at last, I again would like to request you on what particular area of our prosperity that geoscience can contribute for the well-being of the people. Please, from that perspectives, the very technical data, technical works only is not a solution. Sometimes it creates a problem. And solution of one problem is to create a new problem. This is also the reality. But it will go in a new height. So please, these four are the very basic building blocks of economic side. And for the people side, good governance, comprehensive democracy, social protection, equity and justice, nationality, national unity, environmental and ecosystem balance are very important. So these, on those total 10 national big agendas, how geoscience can contribute. This will be identified, and if you go through this way, definitely these papers will be of high values. They will have space on the publication process in international journal as well, and for the government also it will help a lot. In spite of all those things, still we have so many shocks and so many risks. So as you are the cream and purely scientific related activities based works oriented scientist, you need to think from different perspective. So how the adverse effect of climate change, environmental degradation, pandemic, earthquake, or war, or future other unseen and unforeseen risks can be coped up by the nations. You all need to think at one point of the box of your study. 95% you can contribute to your own area of expertise where you are qualified and you are professional. But 5%, please keep it on the box, that there is always risk. So how we can mitigate it and go ahead for making a country prosperous. So we need a very resilient, shock responsive development model now. We are seeking for that. So scientists, please, you work for that. And your support, your contribution is always welcome, always anticipated. And finally, I would like to congratulate the Zoological Society of Nepal. The society has been working a lot, and I have been involved with this society since so long. So even if I have so many other works to accomplish in the mission, I quit them and I always remain here because I delighted to see you all and I can learn a lot from you during this conference. I learned a lot from you. So I thank all of you, all the collaborative partners, all the stakeholders, government stakeholders, private sectors, academia, university, university professor, those who belong to this event directly or indirectly. I would like to congratulate you all. I wish you all very much success or grand success of this conference, and for especially the foreigners, please enjoy your stay at a beautiful city, Pokhara. It is so-called capital city of tourism of Nepal. You enjoy its beauty. And I also would like to wish you return home or travel back home safely and keep connected with our scholars from your level best and try to collaborate your institution or yourself individually to make your agenda a success in future. With this all, I would like to conclude my very short remarks and see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you for your remarks and your guidance, and I'm sure that the geoscientific communities will contribute to develop nation from our perspective, and that will be incorporated in the next phase of plan prepared by, will be prepared by National Planning Commission. So to, we would like to honor our chair and co-chairs and presenters. So to do that, may I request Monica Jha, Vice President, Nepal Geological Society, to honor our chair and co-chairs.
Thank you, sir, for your precious time.
We are really encouraged and motivated. Now, I would like to request Monica Jha to... I'd like to request, thank you, sir. Now I'd like to request Mr. Neera Singh Chaudhary. Now I'd like to request presenter Dr. Kaviraj Pavel. Now I'd like to request Shiva Kumar Biskota to come to the dais. Our chiefs, co-chiefs, and deputy chiefs for our wonderful session conduction.
Plenary session 7, where we have 4 presentations. Seismology and engineering related subjects. And our first speaker is Professor Laurent Bollinger from France. So he is a member of the Department of Earth and Environmental Science in France, which is part of the Atomic Energy and Alternative Energy Commission in France. They are responsible for seismic alert in France. And since 1978, they are involved in a capacity building for the Global Seismological Network in Nepal. And Laurent calls himself a seismotectonician and says since early times he had a passion in mountains and in Nepal, and is now also very happy that he has the opportunity to continue this in Nepal. Since 2008, he is the geographic correspondent Nepal of the DAS Institute in France, in charge of collaboration in seismology. And now we are looking forward on Laurent's presentation.
Let's first introduce the setting. As you all know, millions are exposed to large and great earthquakes here, mainly in Madagascar. And so this is due to the fact that large and great earthquakes rupture partially or totally the main Himalayan thrust, which is the plate boundary fault between India and the Himalayas. So, latest example of a partial rupture is Gorkha earthquake 2015, which ruptured halfway the rock fault zone. And last example in Nepal of total rupture of a great earthquake, last from 1934 with the total rupture of the rock fault zone from the toe of the Himalayas up to the main fault crust. So any information on the seismological segmentation of the fault system is subfault may help better constrain the relative frequency of the large and great earthquakes and their maximum magnitude. So it's very helpful for designing the seismic alert problem. The BIM model realization with large and great earthquakes was reproduced by viscoelastoplastic simulations. Here is the description of Danzio's work. So he reproduced this bimodal seismicity with blind earthquakes clustering at the down deep end of the MHT, provided that he injected his model friction variations and or non-planar geometry. And we know that the main thrust is non-planar because several structural geologists documented very well the flats and the ramps of the main thrust system. So today's question will be, do we see the signatures of groove structures at depth or friction variations at depth in the Nepalese microseismicity, and whether we see lateral variation of behavior of the frost system. So I will do that using partly the data acquired in the framework of the long-lasting collaboration between DAS and DMG. This collaboration began in 1978, and after 1988 Nepal earthquake, so the King of Nepal demanded to France the expansion of the national network. So the network was expanded in the 1990s. Was then 20 station network telemetered at two centers, the regional seismic center of Sokalbin and Nandagar, and the national Nepalese seismic center of Kathmandu. So the mission of DVG in Nepal is to release a seismic alert for earthquakes with ML greater than 4, and it has also other missions. But we collaborate on this research on the seismicity. And so the historical work on this included seminal works by Pandey, by Philippe Bavouac. So I've represented here some of the early results on the location of the seismicity at depth along the mid-crustal ramps. And I've also spotted the work by Soudian Rajore on the relocation of the mid-crustal microseismicity. So the Gorkha earthquake hit the network, but fortunately, because of the good maintenance, as well as the because of the robustness of the old technologies, the network was able to was sustainable during the first few months after the Gorkha earthquake. But we had to update it within a few months after the main shock. So we updated it from analog network to digital network. So the station of the network still contributes to more than 50% of the stations deployed in Nepal and used for seismological purposes. So the work presented hereafter was done with the contribution of the Abjida's stations and a temporary experiment we deployed in far western Nepal under the French National Research Agency. Just go to that show where that we have a larger study of the VPVS ratio, for example. So here is a focus on what happened north of Kathmandu. So the right stepping strands of the high aftershock rates. So here is the same area before the Gorkha earthquake. So you see that this maximum of aftershock rate that felt at the down deep extension of the maximum of slip of Gorkha earthquake, there were lot of earthquakes located there a few years before the Gorkha earthquake. And you see that the microcrystal ramp here, seen from the aftershock that happened in the 1990s and early 2000, fall 15 kilometers to the south within that seismic cluster. And so at that time, we interpreted that as right stepping strands of the ramps north to the Kathmandu PP. And so here is a tear fault between the mid-crustal ramp. And so this tear fault seismicity is illustrated here. It's a cross section through this tear fault between the ramp. So we do here are two maps of the aftershock, the seismicity rate before and after the Gorkha earthquake. As you see, there are a lot of heterogeneity, lateral variation. You see here several maximums, and so this maximum only fell at the precise place where you have yellow circle. So this yellow circle corresponds to a high frequency burst during the rupture of the Gorkha earthquake. And you see that this high frequency burst happened at places where you have the cross-seismicity, but then that changes a little bit. So this is quite promising because then it might suggest that the segmentation and depth just could be of importance for better understanding the cross-seismic rupture. And as you see here, these yellow circles correspond to the peak of the aftershock rates along during the 5 years that followed the earthquake. So what did we learn from Gorkha earthquake? We learned that structural depth likely controlled the cross-seismic rupture, its extent, the slip distribution, the rupture velocity that varied between 2.7 and 3.3 kilometers per second, the high-frequency seismic burst. And so it has some implication on the deep segmentation of the fault system, which likely controls the extent of the rupture of intermediate and probably larger earthquakes in Nepal too. So do we see the signature of loose structure or friction variation in the Nepalese macroseismicity or its behavior? The answer just could be yes. And so we've seen persistent lateral variation of the macroseismicity, which are visible through the seismic cycle in Kathmandu. So what we did is that we went to far western Nepal. It's a region where you have very large heterogeneity in terms of aftershock rates. So you have the mid-crustal cluster here, which is unique at the toe of the Api Himal, Api Saibai Himal, and that divides into two strands of mid-crustal clusters. So the national network of Nepal was deployed here, and with many stations to the south. And so the azimuthal gap
for these earthquakes is very large, and therefore it's very difficult to determine the depth of the seismicity in this region. So it's the reason why when we do cross-section in this catalog, in fact, we have a diffuse seismicity, but this diffuse seismicity is probably only a bias. So what we did is that we complemented the network with 15 stations we deployed above the seismic cluster. So the seismos were installed within buckets sealed in concrete slab, just in the region of maximum earthquake rates. They were visited every 6 months for servicing. So on the photo you see a lot of people involved. You will recognize probably Mukunda Batarai, Takur Kandel, Ratnamadiputta, Rosa Oskolome, that participated in this experiment. So I won't detect the workflow, but we had a workflow a little bit different than the workflow that is deployed at the National Seismic Center. So we used first an automatic picking method, then a manual repeat in order to locate very precisely the earthquake. And we used the various techniques of location and relocation. In parallel, Shiba Subedi worked on the seismic imagery below the network using teleseismic records at the station that were deployed in order to image the crust below the stations. And so he did one receiver function analysis. So here is the map of the high quality located earthquakes. So the network allowed detecting 4,500 earthquakes. Among them, half were tagged as high quality because they were associated with more than 6 PGX, 3 SPX, very low RMS, and therefore we are very confident on the location at depth of this earthquake within an error ellipse of less than 2 km. So what we did also is we compared what was obtained by the RSC lab in order to try to document potential bias of the national network in order to correct some of them. So as a matter of example, you see here two zooms on two clusters, one in Bajong area, one in North Karnali. And you see here in red the location of the RSC event. And in gray, the ICANET events while the instruments were above. And so you see that there's a shift by about 8 kilometers. It's not that big, but in fact, the shape of some of the clusters just changed. 8 kilometers is more or less the translation corresponds approximately to the translation at depth of the earthquake. Dr. Subedi's results were published here in a paper in JRN in 2019. He demonstrated that below some of the station, below the network, you see here a red zone here, this corresponds to the Moho. So the boundary between the base of the Indian crust and the top of the Indian mantle. So the Moho is very well imaged. And he imaged also here blue over red areas that correspond to a low velocity zone as I've mentioned for Kathmandu. And so he documented that on two cross sections. So you see on one cross section we have a good idea of the position of the MHT at depth here on in far western Nepal and here in Karnali area. When we take the relocated hypocenter and confront them to this cross-section, it happens that most of the small earthquakes that happen within the low velocity zone, or low velocity. So when we confront this mid-crustal seismicity with balanced cross-section that were, like Dolores Robinson, balanced cross-section that were documented a few years before, we see that most of the cluster happened in the vicinity of the main event thrust, and most probably most of them in the hanging wall of the MHT. So you see here a cluster at the toe of the active ramp, which is one of the most active cluster, but you see also several other clusters in the hanging wall, and most of them fall at the junction of in between the Lesser Himalayan slivers. So here is the cross section through Karnali area. So here was the cross section published in 2018 with the first year of experiment by Rosa Oscolomé. But during the second year, we used different technique. We had more events, and we were able to refine the location of the microcrystal earthquake, determine focal mechanisms. And so we could document some clusters nearby a microcrystal ramp here to the front, as well as along a main microcrystal ramp here to the north. So here, the seismicity expressed within this cluster corresponds to a cluster of earthquake that happened that activated the back thrust at the toe of the ramp, because the system is very difficult to move, and so sometimes at the hinge of the hanging wall you nucleate earthquakes and make the back thrust play. So so what's worth it is that now we have several clusters with nice time structure of earthquakes, and so absolute replication of those clusters help understand better the mechanisms responsible for them at depth. So some of these clusters were main shock after shock, some of them are related to other things. So here, for example, is an example of a cluster in which you have had a bilateral migration of the seismicity. So you see from the first earthquake that the distance from the first earthquake
Sir, 5 minutes left?
Yeah. So you see that the seismicity front migrated 50 meters per day on both sides of the cluster core. And so it helps us suggest that, it makes us suggest that this is related to fluids at depth or eventually supercritical CO2 at depth. So, to conclude, more than 4,000 earthquakes were located below the IGNET experiment, among which 2,200 with very small uncertainty ellipses, most of them clustered in swarm, most clustered at intersection between the MHT and the contact between Lesser Himalayan slivers in the hanging wall. The seismicity reveals indirectly ramps and flat geometry of the full system, with the largest ramp likely to partially control the rupture of intermediate or large earthquakes. The ramp that on which Gorkha earthquake rupture abutted is only 3 kilometers high, and in far western Nepal, several ramps are 4 to 5 kilometers high, and that could may segment sufficiently well the main thrust to produce both intermediate earthquake and large earthquake too. So 6 distinct fault segments with different seismic behavior were delineated after the experiment. So the perspective are that the improvement of the pre-Gorkha catalog, taking into account all the biases revealed by the dense temporary experiment, for a better evaluation of the seismogenic behavior at depth, the structural control of the rupture, and future seismological deployments are required to refine these variations of seismicity on strike. Thank you very much. So this research, thank you.
For the Hydromodel Development of Nepal, and today I'm going to share my experience in the engineering geology in the hydropower development, what are the design and challenges. Target of my presentation will be brief introduction. The main thing is understanding of georigs with the case study. Then to the how we assess the georigs, with then to prediction and design consideration, final the concluding remark. Introductions, as already said, theoretically hydropower potential, Nepal has hydropower potential of 83 megawatt. Out of that only we have harnessed around 2000 megawatt plus. So the engineering geology plays the dominant role in the every decisions of selection of a dam, major structures, based on the engineering geology. That major part of the engineering geology is the assessment of geotechs, then prediction and the design considerations. So understanding of geotechs, hydropower structures are normally built in the geological material sensitive, so we always pose the geotechs. And if you see different country and literatures, most of the hydropower projects suffer from the geotechs, and its cost overrun, then delay is major cost by the geotechs. So recent example in Nepal we can consider is the construction delay of the headrest tunnel of the Chameliar, Lower Sono, Modi, due to the deformation of the squeezing and reshaping, it's a loss of cost. Similarly, there are tunnel collapses geotechs like delay several projects, minimum 1 month to 12 months. We have a lot of example on that. This picture is, we have to visualize the geotechs. If we construct our hydropower structures in this fault and shear zone, whether it could be constructible or not, we have to visualize this kind of thing. So I try to classify the geotechs, the types, just like in divided into two types. It will delay the project, as I already said, 1 month to minimum 12 months. It means a lot of delay and a lot of cost. Similarly, these are the, some of the examples from this is the Dordi project, and this one is Somalia, and this one Modi, and this one is from Dharpala. And this project is Khanipala, and delay almost one year to reconstruct this tunnel. Finally diverted the tunnel and crossed the tunnel alignment. Similarly, this is Sanigarh and Upper Kalanga project. It's also delayed 6 months to 1 year. Likewise, is rock squeezing is also common geotechs during the tunnel constructions. It's normally occur in the weak rock shear zones and in presence of water, and it contain in the shear zones contain a lot of inconsiderate amount of clay, mica, chlorides, talc, serpentine, and gypsums. So tunnel will be squeezed and we have to re-excavate if deformation is very high. It will cost a lot. So these are the, some of the examples from the Melamchi water supply tunnel. This after 4 days tunnel was totally closed. They re-excavated and they are, it's very risky. Likewise, in this is in the Modi project, it's, you can see the all steel ribs and the inverted movement from, and this is the Somalia project, and reshaping after the tunnel was reshaped. Similarly, this is the Lower Sono project. It's almost 1.5 meter deformation at the wall. It's also the Modi project. So they have to reshape and reconstruct the tunnel. Another one is rock cross and spalling geotechs. This is not very common in Nepal because, but there are some of the examples we can get. Just like we can get popcorn brush and cracking notice in the Melamchi tunnel. Its cover is around 1100 meters. Similarly, popping from the face of the Mandu Bagmati, its rock cover is greater than 800 meters. Another one is in Nilgiri 2 project, is like a bone brush sound in after 1 hour of blastings, and wall crack after 2-3 months. So these are not actually the dangerous as the rock boss in the mining. So water ingress and water leakage are the another risk during the tunnel constructions. Water ingress will delay the project and very risky, and flooding and pumping will be very costly. Similarly, the water leakage through the tunnel during the filling is another risk. These are some of the examples from Nilgiri 2 project, you can see the very high pressure water is coming from, and it's very difficult for the construction of tunnel because of all filling in the tunnel, and continuous pumping is needed. So the negative gradient tunnel will be the best for this kind of, if we can predict earlier. Similar, these are the water leakage example from Chaku, Upper Mai, and Khimti. So considerable amount of water is leaked through the tunnel. So we have to re-grout, post-grout, and this is the one example for Khimti. 200 LPS, this is unacceptable leakage. So 874 tons grouting was done later on. Some surface georigs. Major is the landslide georigs because we'll construct the hydropower structures by cutting the slopes, majority. So there are majority is three kind of slope stability rigs during the hydropower, the spot slope induced landslide, then drawdown induced landslide in the reservoir area, and water leakage induced landslide during the water filling or some of the area. These are some of the example of Sanjen is the power of squatting slope. Is this is the Khimti portal landslide, and this is Upper Mahdi to Kri was dead because of this landslide collapse and the tunnel was closed. Similarly, foundation failure settlement is also georigs we found during the, especially for the powerhouse and the settling basin structures, is in the middle Modi is contained the clay silt deposit, so we have to, there is a differential settlement. In similarly, in my cascade project in the Four Bay area is founded in the sand, so there are the, some settlement was noticed. Later we have to rig out by the microfine cements. Then similarly, low guard settling basin, its foundation is very very loose soil with the floating boulders, then we have to replace and recompact the area for the foundations. And this is natural geohazard, is prone to the Himalayan river, so this kind of landslide and bluff will destroy the structures. So we have to, very assessing will be very important. This is the Upper Chaku from, this is the flood damage, the powerhouse of Upper Chaku is completely upstream landslide, and every flow event is damaged the Upper Chaku and kills the two employees. If we have all dwelling system installed, then we can save the life. Similarly, in Superdori catchment area, there are two, three hydropower projects under construction. In 2019 is a debris flow event and dead 10 people. And can save the life by the early warning system if we have installed there. This is the bluff event from the July 2016, and this is the Bhotegosi project now, and after bluff event it's totally destroyed the settling basin and dam wear, and it took 2-3 years to reconstruct this project. Similarly, orchid induced georigs, some of the example is totally buried the settling basin by the landslide and destroyed the settling basin by the rock falls in Moirung project. Similarly, ruptured the Bhotegosi penstock pipe and flooded the downstream the powerhouse. And these are some of the examples of how the earthquake induced. And 10 centimeter settlement in the 114 meter high rock field dam of the Kulekhani, they reduced the level for the safety of the project. And georisk assessment, BIP method we have to use, that is means first visualize the georigs, then investigate, then predict the georigs for the design steps. So the visualization is the, we have to list all the georigs, whatever problem in the structures. Then investigations, we have to do the investigation and construct the geological model, what will be the risks. Then after that, we will predict the time consequences, likelihood and severity of the georigs. So let's take examples for the visualization of georigs. We have reached out just like dam, quartz slope, stability, foundation, failure, settlement, water leakage and other natural disasters, if it is risks or not. Similarly, underground. So after listing this kind of theories, we'll do the site investigations. And there are, in Nepal, site investigation is very challenging because of the rough terrain and hilly regions. Transportation is very costly, and deep drilling is very difficult. So the investment cost for the by the developer is very little, and they don't want to invest in the investigations. So these are the challenges, and method will be more focused only in the geological mapping, because most of the model is relying on the geological mapping. So in we have to focus on the source of georigs is the fault shear zone. These are the major source of georigs. We can identify by the aerial photo and satellite image, but that will only can identify the very steep fault, because in the Himalaya major shear zone and faults are along the foliation plain, and it's very difficult to detect. So there are also field evidences, and major source identification is morphological feature is very important for the identifications. If you see this photo, there is a steep fault and a very straight alignment we can see. But very good example is, this is the Koshi River, Saptakoshi River, and this is Saptakoshi high dam area around. This river is diverted rectangular because there is a MCT here, displacement. So if you see the topo map, and there are abnormal structures like this pressure ridge. So these are the some of the indication and relict of the shear zones we can identify. And then, of course, we have to do the surface investigation to confirm the depth and thickness of. These are the some of the one example. This is the abnormal topography, and we did electric resistivity. Then we found some abnormal here. They're also confirmed by the drilling later on. So and another thing is assessment fault is very important part of the, because in regional geological map, if you find in Nepal, there is a contact, thrust contact was placed in the regional geological map. Here is midline thrust between the Ulleri Gneiss, and but if you go to the field, there is no such kind of engineering point of view, nothing else there. We can construct very easily. So this is the very important for the assessment and fault. Now these are the, this one is the map from the Khimti. This is during the feasibility study, and there are only shown the few shear zones. So after construction, there are so many, more than, so the project was actually cost overrun, but it was fixed price contract. Contractor was lost. And there are physical, geophysical method we also applied, that is seismic, ERT, MAM. So these are some of the examples from, is there is identify the paleo channel, and we have to seek the tunnel towards the rock, and this is a SRT example. Another good example is the Galamdi tunnel is straight. They don't identify the paleo channel. They hit with columnium boulders with a tree trunk. Later we did the geophysical investigations. It showed the paleo channel with a landslide deposit, then diverted the tunnel from here, because this is the area shown here. Geological model is very important. After investigations, we have to construct the geological model, means plan and sections in the 3D view. So each and every structure, we have to construct the geological model, and then we have to predict the, these are some of the examples of the dam geological model alone, showing the rock with some shear band, and is the rock and soil excavation profile. Similarly, this is the tunnel geological model. It's plan showing the its shear zones here and the syncline fold. This is the power of geological model, and each and every bedrock and shear zone are constructed here. So it's easy to predict and georigs and the rock support design. This is the surface power of geological model. It's plan and construct the bedrock, and how we got there is a weak sand deposit here, thick groundwater table is below this one.
So similarly, these are the foundation design modifications we have done. It's here in the Modi, is done the soil replacement methods. Similarly, in Middle Power, with a border with a very placid design, we have replaced with a geo grid and layer and compactions. Similarly, in Nilgiri project is the columnium with lots of boards inside, so replace the 4 meter that routing, they improve the foundations. And rock mass quality estimation is very challenging. This is because we have to mostly rely on the geological map, and from seeing the surface, we have to project down to the tunnel level. So it's not easy, but however, we have to do intensive investigation and data collection. We can also take from the experience from the other project, similar project type of the rock, then estimate the rock mass distribution in the range, because we cannot do the exact estimations. Similarly, these are some of the visual, like if you have this very massive rock, Q value is greater than 10, then we expect the tunnel without support. It's very, but if we have the shear zones, is down, we expect the overbreak flowing around and the rock squeezing. So these are the tunnel and overbreak collapse we can normally have in fault shear zone and highly jointed rock mass having very less stand-up time. We have to support within the stand-up time because it has not self-supporting capacity. So design will be, we have to construct the geological model and identify the shear zone in other areas, then if we try, if it is possible, we have to douse or divert the tunnel. If it is not possible, then we have to go for the pre-treatment and the excavation method and the rock support for the estimation of squeezing intensity. So if we find the low strength rock fault shear zone containing considerable amount of talc and micaceous mineral, that is potential for rock squeezing. And strain is 25 MPa below that, and with a lot of micaceous content, percentage is very high. And we have to check the in situ stress and overburden. Then orientation of foration is very important part, and the seepage conditions. But if the overburden pressure, overburden is greater than 200, it is difficult to sever squeezing and very difficult to handle. There are some prediction empirical method. There are we can predict, but the for the greater depth, numerical modeling will be necessary for the design of rock support and constructability. Then circular with the base for the to control the squeezing. Then we need pre-reinforcement if face is intruding inside. So then the excavation method is very important. Heading, benching, side drip, it depends on the size of the tunnel. And yielding support is still set with a side sliding joint. And the circuit with the like this, it will control the convergence.
Sir, 5 minutes left.
Okay, thank you. And these are the rock works and georics. We can also, there are empirical relations. And if potential and heavy rock works, then we have to reduce the height of the tunnel or we go for the design of rock support. So finally, the rock support design, we have to mainly done by the NGI method by the Q systems, and we little modified for the instead of reinforced ribs or something, we use the ribs or lattice girder. So up to the Q value, one above the one is no problem for me. This is quite good. But below the value and high pressure, numerical modeling is the most needed for the design of rock support. And concluding MMR, engineering geology plays a very decisive role in each and every structure of hydropower project. Then georisk is the major cost factor. Then a major role for the georisk assessment and management. Then the key thing is if we construct the precise geological model, that will give the successful project without any georisk. Thank you very much.
I give credit to Rita Thakuri, who is my colleague at NSET, and she is also the network coordinator of the Asian Disaster Reduction and Response Network of over 65 civil society alumni devoted to disaster risk management spread in 20 countries of Asia Pacific region. The Gorkha earthquake. For me also it was a watershed because the earthquake, after the earthquake, I retired from my institution, although the passion continues. And really, it was the watershed. And I'm trying to prove how all the efforts that was done for more than two decades for meeting this particular earthquake, how it paid off. So it was a wonderful watershed. Let me go. Moshe Wolin here just now talked about the Gorkha earthquake. I just want to point out that two aftershocks within a day, and these are significant aftershocks, and then about within 2 weeks, the big aftershock. So, and our Gopi, Krishna Prasad, he calculated that the co-seismic landslides generated by this earthquake were worth the landslide happened in 200 years' time. So it was a huge number of landslides, and then a million buildings damaged, nearly half a million destroyed totally, and the rest seriously damaged. So that is the synopsis of Gorkha earthquake impact. And before that, the country was suffering from almost a decade or more of civil strife, armed insurgency, and a lot of confusion in the society. And after that, another decade was in political chaos in the country. So the country was in almost, in a social way, it was a lack of focus and lack of almost like a direction of for development. And in the background, I continuously heard, especially after the earthquake, everybody, especially those resident in Kathmandu, the foreigners who were our development partners, they kept on reminding us, hey, you are like a Japan-like hazard situation and Haiti-like vulnerabilities. So it was something like a very difficult situation, and it was very difficult to keep your confidence within yourself if you want to do something in the country. So that was the background when the earthquake struck, and here's how it shook. Strangely, the intensity level were scattered, as you see, the epicentrum, which is about 9 or 8.5. But most of the Kathmandu is shook with 6.5 and rarely with something like a 7. So at that time, contrast with what happened in 1934, the map may be questionable because those stages are prepared, but this is the intensity 9 plus, and then the rest of the value was 8 and 7. So that contrasted very sharply with the 1934 earthquake, and that 1934 earthquake is a reference for Nepal. So the earthquake was expected, but the consequences were unexpected. And Kathmandu was perhaps lucky for that level of that magnitude of the earthquake, but still we sustained a lot of damage in Kathmandu, especially those buildings that were poorly maintained and very old buildings. But anyway, we were lucky that the earthquake also took place on Saturday when the schools were closed. So after the earthquake, we didn't turn into Haiti. We addressed the emergency response quite with confidence. Imagine almost like, where is that? Huge number of international agencies came to help us, and Nepal could coordinate that influx of search and rescue agencies. But then the nation also stood very fast, and within a couple of months, The PDN, the preliminary disaster needs assessment, was prepared. And it was wonderful that the transfer agencies, the government agencies, the local NGOs, all experts, even individuals, could get involved in that. And it's wonderful practice led by the National Planning Commission. That was it. I mean, it was perhaps the first time that everybody was, you know, together to develop that PDN. And it accepted the principles of build back better. Very, very wonderful concept, but not that easy to understand concept. Within effective 5 years, well, although spread over 6 years, almost 6 years, with all the hiccups, 84% of the building built back better, with problems, but built back better. They are earthquake resistant. This is the private buildings, and buildings where housing were the half of the impact in terms of economy. Educational buildings, 82% built back better, and then this is the public structures, the government structures. But we have these red circles here. We have a problem with our cultural heritages, we have problems with our hospital and health institutions, we have problems with our security, the structures of the security agencies, and we have some problem with our other infrastructure, and here I saw the water supply. So, good and bad together. I now go to what we did as an institution in this reconstruction process, and just look at these figures. So, NSET, my institution, 2,554 engineers involved in reconstruction were trained by us, 13,000 masons, social mobilizers, wonderful agents in the disaster emergency response and also reconstruction. Wonderful, they are much better. They delivered, I think, personally for me, especially more than 50% of them were female, and they delivered, their value of their services is, for me, better, much better, several times more than what I could deliver or what engineers could deliver. So, it was quite a successful and quite a satisfying things to do, anyway. And based upon certain principles of technically feasible, economically it should be affordable, we are pleased. It should be culturally acceptable, it should be using the locally available material, and it has to be sustainable, but it has to be based on science. So my institutions, thanks to a grant by the British government and implemented by UN system, and Beijing University was involved in that, and Kunming University was involved at our request and with the facilitation of our government, we could do series of tests for our local buildings, because we don't have the shake table here for testing the typology that we were requesting for the owner-driven approach building. So it was based upon evidence-based, tested, and then recommended in most of the cases. So here I say that it was a watershed, and all the work that was done before the almost like 2 decades, essentially since the early or mid 70s that we started doing the disaster reduction. We learned quite a bit from the earthquake that happened in Nepal in 1988, Udaipur earthquake. We knew how the buildings damaged. They damaged, but didn't know how they damaged. And then also we learned from the 1993 floods, especially in terms of emergency response and what are required for helping the people who are at risk or who were affected. And then we owned the concept, the global concept of the International Decade for Natural Disaster Reduction, where many European countries led the process and helped us. And the Yokohama Conference and its resolution, time for action, the Hugo framework for action, and the preparation for the Sendai framework for disaster risk reduction. And in this process, Nepal developed its own national action plan for disaster risk management, and that was, you know, being implemented for the last 2 decades, reluctantly by some, but very enthusiastically and passionately by others. So it was a combination. This is Building Good Implementation Act. Prior to earthquake, you know, organized, started in 2012, 2016. Red one is non-compliant building. Yellow is partially compliant, non-fatal non-compliant. And green is fully compliant. Fully means 95% compliant. Look at this. In 2 years' time, you jump from 14 to 25, and you know, from 81 to bring it down to 61%, and then in 2000, another 2 years' time, you reduce from 81%, this was not working, to 23%. It is possible to construct strong building that would withstand the earthquake. As for all, people were skeptical. They think that you Nepalese are corrupt. Your engineers are corrupt. They pocket the money. The problem lies in lack of capacity. And if you help municipalities to provide. And what I'm saying is applicable everywhere. That was what we see in India during after the Bhuj earthquake, and also in Pakistan after the Dashi earthquake. Unfortunately, well, thank you very much. Yesterday, I heard about the importance of science. Everybody, our big leaders, say, but then in Nepal, unless there is a foreign assistance, there is virtually no research for our purposes. Unfortunate situation this is. I'm going to finish. So, but then we learned from the watershed. We developed policies, required policies, that were almost in a state of constipation for 3 decades. But then, what happened first? The policy, right policy now, and also institutionalization like the NRA and also the NDRMA and the disaster portals and others. So we are in the right path, and numerous programs and projects are being run now, national, at the federal level, provincial and municipality level. And I just want to, I mean, I was fascinated last week by Rajendra Sharma, who talked about the early warning system and the state of the art early warning system being installed in Nepal with radar, which can also capture the cloud bursts and these events. So it is fascinating to see what this earthquake has done to us. We suffered a lot, but it has taught us lesson, and we are very much, you know, in action with all the problems the government. The government is hitting, and we are following that. And it is in working. This slide is also going to see Rajendra Sharma from NDRMA. So we have got huge opportunities. The pattern of 2 decades ago, it has virtually gone away. Nobody talks about the, you know, rage of the God for that to happen. So we have got a group policy. We have got increasing subscription to this idea that hazards are natural, but disasters are human induced. So we are making disaster. And then we are getting on the hey. The young practitioners are there, the digital technology and the space technology, even ENSET is using, and you see the poster, and our Gopiji, he talked yesterday. What he didn't mention is that, like the ENSET shape table, he has devised a landslide demonstrator that is wonderful for awareness raising and working with the people and involving them in the entire process of understanding the hazard and also devising the mitigation options. And we have got an old philosophy of what we call the Panchashila, which includes respecting the nature and then our traditional knowledge in this.
So DRR is not not anything for us, but the challenges remain and they are tough. We have got environmental problems, climate risk, urbanization and the resulting problems, inequality and poverty are there. The disasters are increasing in terms of their magnitude and frequency and unexpectedness, consequential cascading effect. And unfortunately, we continue living with the reactive mindset of post-disaster activities and not a very conservative approaches. We need even the scientific community, excuse me for that, and among our administrators and policymakers. And what I was wondering is that last couple of days, I was looking into the election manifesto of the various political parties and looking how intense they were talking about disaster mitigation. 6 years after the earthquake, there is no seriousness. And I started crying. It's not a good thing. We should not forget the earthquake story here. This should be, and we have to educate the policymakers and the politicians to talk and internalize this risk. Otherwise, I believe that we did not encourage us. It is difficult for us to do any research and to advance science. I thank you very much for your attention.
You can see here I am standing. And today I'll be talking only about rocks, no swipes. So you can see here, this is many may think that it is very hard rock. It is not, it is a typical thalite. And if thalite is also very acted properly, it can hold quite a lot of load. So this is what we should learn to understand. So we discussed many faults or errors in design and planning. Basically, what are the major aspects is how to plan a tunneling project or a road where you have to cut the slope. This is very important. So with this, so today I'll be discussing about methods applied for the stability assessment in rock engineering. So I am very fortunate today that Suhasi has given a very good background. I don't need to go on that, so I'll go directly to the methods. So the methods are not oriented to empiricism. It is oriented more to analytical approaches so that we know there are other ways, possibilities to do the design. So through this lecture, I will be going through four different areas, or three different areas. One is a brief introduction, and I go through the slope stability. This is also an issue for Nepal. And then stability assessment of tunnels and caverns, so we can do that. Of course, Suhasi highlighted about empirical approach, use of Q method. And then I will discuss about the tunnels in the shallow seated or low overburden areas. And I'll go through the deep seated tunnels with brittle rock mass, meaning high strength rock. We have such many of such rocks. And then we have tunnels in deformable or squeezing rock mass, where we have many deformations that the Suhasi has demonstrated earlier. And then I'll conclude my presentation here. So with the introduction, so areas where we need rock engineering knowledge is assessment of the natural and cut slope failures, of course. This is very important. Design of dam and bridge foundations is very important. There are many failures in Nepalese bridge foundation, in fact. And then planning and design of hydropower tunnels and caverns. Because when we build hydropower, always there is a powerhouse cavern and settling basin caverns may be there. And then road and railway tunnels that we have started discussing about. And then tunnels and caverns for city metros, drainage and sewage disposal. It is not the right time issue here, but it will come over the development. Caverns for sports hall will come in future. Caverns for storage of food, because we can reserve quite a lot of energy, save energy by storing things inside the mountain. oil and gas is much better to store inside the mountain, then it will be much safer. And then IT and security equipment are even important to store inside, then it will be very long lasting. And we have huge potential in Nepal. If we have a good road network and we do this above 3000 meter above sea level, so then our rock temperature is around 7 degree there. So then it will be, we don't need to do anything, just put there. So it will come in the future. So caverns for defense shelter are also an issue, of course, in today's world. And then mining activities, both open pit and underground mining. These are the areas where we should use our knowledge in rock engineering. So an example of rock engineering I could say about Norway, you see here. In 1970s, the statistic is from 1970s. So they had almost 4 million cubic meter solid cubic meter excavation of rock. And out of that, about 10% was for road tunnels, rest for hydropower. And we are somewhere here. Not that extent, but we are somewhere here. We have almost no road tunnels. We have just started, and we are building many hydropower tunnels. You see here, over we develop the energy, nation goes developed, and they will be better and better. And then road tunnel is also increasing. This is typical in the mountainous country. And it will be even faster here, I think, in future. And then there was economic recession and it fell down, and now it is again very high activity. But you see, most of the activities are related to the road tunnels. Because people need better roads, safer roads. So therefore, there is a huge activity in Norway. Even today, we have over 4 million cubic meter solid excavation every year. And the peak was 8 million cubic meter. So this is an example of urban areas where one could have many tunnels crossing below, but nobody knows, right? So this is the beauty of exploiting underground. So you can utilize your surface area for your purpose, for gardens, for parks, and for many other things, and then you put everything inside. So this is a typical example. So then why rock engineering is needed for us is because we have many students here. To understand engineering geological conditions, where an engineering structure should be located, to carry out planning, design, and construction in a proper manner, to optimize construction cost, and check whether projects are financially feasible or not, and to make sure that the structure is stable for both short-term and long-term, because it is very important, both short-term and long-term. Because during short-term, the workers are worried about the stability, they don't want to work in the risk area. For the long term, we have to secure that our stability is there until the project financial viability exists. So that means over 100 years. So to carry out research and establish design criteria and analysis without doing rock engineering assessment in a proper way and collecting data, we cannot do that. So this is very important. So if we go to the rock slope stability, for example, you see here, there are two planar failures here. This is along the slope, along the road of the Tamakosi. So there is a huge slip of this block, typical plane failure, and this is a Norwegian case. After the contractor built the road, they did not identify a planar joint here. And then suddenly the rock mass failed. So such types of things happen everywhere, not only here. So then, you see here, I have given some principal thought. You see, this is a block, and it is cut in between. And still it is not sliding. So it has its own property, frictional property, right? So therefore it is holding here. And here you see, this is even interesting. So this block should have been rolled down, but it is holding by this block, which has a
major roadway to this rock mass, so therefore it is still there. But if there is some acceleration, so then it will go down. So it means what is important is that we have a normal load of this sliding block and we have a friction cone. So do we have friction cone larger than the angle of the slope? Is the first thought one should do when one does stability assessment in the top slope. And then if we look on the joints that are not very smooth, so the failure envelope will not be straight as has been indicated here. It will be somehow sublinear here. Okay? So then to address this, we have this bottom bendish criteria, the failure. Barton, who is the main author who to propose the rock mass classification Q system in the same table. So this is the approach one should use. So then once we see this frictional property area, so then the steps for slope stability assessment are okay. We should follow the three different steps. First is we should define the problem. How we do the definition is that we do the engineering topological mapping, detailed engineering topological mapping, we should have the geometry of the slope, and then after that we can find out which type of failure will be meeting here. So you see here, this is a typical plane failure, this is typical wedge failure, and this is typical circular failure. So then the second step is of course assessment of input parameters where the risk lies. So risk lies both on mapping and finding out the input parameters. What is the best way to find out? So what is the mechanical properties? What are the frictional properties? How is the groundwater condition and seismic acceleration coefficient is very important. And once we establish these things, and then we have to find out what is the strength of this failing block, or what is the load. So the strength should be always higher than the load. So it means we can do this through limit equilibrium or probability or numerical modeling. So the factor of safety is governed by stabilizing forces divided by destabilizing forces, should be more than one, most likely more than 1.5. This is a typical failure with the block pop, and this is the typical failure of the plastic deformation. So use plastic deformation, they apply support in function. So then whole area is collapsing now. And here you can see a typical rock burst. It is at Parvati in Himachal in India. And both fingers from here, this is TBM tunnel and this is the drilling blast tunnel. So we have this type of troubles, but our tunnels have not gone through a high cold water yet. So it will be in the future. So then if we look on the empirical approaches first, so I will briefly say about it because Subhashti discussed quite a lot about it. So then, for example, if we have a typical shallow seated tunnel, so we may have a condition like we may have a block falling here, or we may have a block sliding from here, or from here. So it means the assessment of the block here, how is the weight and how long the bolt I should put is a very important for this. Nothing to do with Q system or RMR system. Mm-hmm. This block will fail no matter how, what kind of Q numbers you will get if you have not put your bolt in a proper location. So this is very important. So here also we can do a short, very quick stability assessment at site. Today we have this many type of pairs thing, and we can make a table this to the conversation, then come back quickly if you have made a programming, small programming. It is very quick to do that nowadays. We are much better in this with technology. So you can see here, so if we have the block here that is falling, so we should have certain length of the anchor, so that it is anchoring this hanging block. Same here, so we should go viewing the
these two disabilities fronting each other, we should have some sentiment inside the mass. So here you can see a typical block falling calculation. So I have not gone in detail about it, but it will be in the article. Okay. So, and then you see here there is some kind of sensitivity analysis. You see, the both residual friction angle and active friction angle are very sensitive. So they depend on the factor of safety rather than deviation they are in. So we should be very careful with it. So with this, I go to the third part. So deep seated tunnels in middle and massive lockmass. For example, here you see there is a chunk of a block that fell down, ejected into the tunnel. And here it is a chunk of the tunnel from where to this very side, you can see there is a falling condition. So if we look on the lockmass, we can see two categories of blocks, category one. Category 2, category 1 are more deformable blocks, so that there is swinging maybe because in main challenges and class 2 blocks are more brittle and massive. They will be retaining with the high intensity sounds if the stress condition is very high. Maximum tangential stress can be calculated using Chris equation here, and then rock mass strength can be calculated using these two equations. This is for both distress rock and this is for both brittle rock mass. So it is very, this way gives a very good idea of how will be the depth impact, and based on that you can design how long you should have rock pressure, for example. So with this we go to the fourth part, tunnel in deformable squeezing rock mass. So you can see here, this is the Kaligandaki tunnel, and here you see the installed steel rib has been completely twisted, and there is almost 70 centimeter movement of this wall. And here this is the body collar, and here almost 1 meter has moved. So this is the typical squeezing. So what is this phenomenon? I can describe a little bit. So say this is a circular tunnel, and then if I take off the rock mass from here, what will happen is the in-situ stresses will be distorted. So then if the rock mass is very weak, so instead of accumulating stress around the tunnel, it will be microfractured. So when the material is microfractured, so it will try to find the expansion area. So since inside here is the rock mass, so then it will be to move towards the tunnel. So this is what the speeding is. And how we barrier it is by applying the support here. So with this, I conclude my presentation here. Purpose-safety assessment demands good knowledge in geology and rock engineering. And this is a geology seminar. And we are so proud of that because of your work, we are able to think about rock mass. If we don't have information from you fellows, it is almost impossible for us to understand how this rock will behave. So use of only rock mass classification methods are not enough for the assessment of stability. Remember that. Empirical methods may be useful during planning but we process. However, a detailed design and construction phases, it is essential that we should use analytical approaches so that we have a clear view of whether our design is accurate or not. The results achieved through analytical methods should also be verified by numerical modeling, because we have quite a lot of numerical modeling tools nowadays, much easy to use. In addition to the method mentioned here, it is necessary to assess potential water inflowing leakage in the tunnels and from the tunnels, of course. This issue is a separate issue. I could give a lecture like this, but I have not talked about it here. The final rock support design must be based on the results of the stability assessment, not by using Q-chart. Okay? During plant construction, it is okay, but final, it should be more analytical, or you should do the numerical one. So this is my last point. Thank you very much. And with this, mostly in support designing of the tunnels, if we have, say, rocks like thin dependent, well foliated like slates or weathered slides, then in this case, how can we quantify the value of RMR and Q?
I touched that issue in my presentation because if you have no fractured rock mass or systematic grind, so Q and RMR system does not work. So we have to do the analytical efforts, like I have shown that we can do the plastic deformation analysis with the system, with the methods that I have proposed. It's only two, you can measure and the methods that we propose. And based on that, you can optimize how much support pressure you will be needing to contain this deformation. There are two ways of thinking, two thoughts of thinking. One is, when you know that how much total deformation without support will occur, so then you can say, okay, I put a clinical support, but I let the tunnel deform. So then what you do is that you increase the size of the tunnel so that it accommodates. And then still you use the circuit, which is hydro circuit and reinforced rate or things like this.
Okay, thank you for this very good suggestion. But in the case of intercalation, you know, sometimes we find the thick beds and then thin beds partings, like partings in the beds of such type of thinly foliated intercalations of soft rocks, and then again hard rocks and soft rocks. So whenever we meet the hard rocks, then do we propose one system and immediately? So in this case, how can we do
this? This is a very tricky question, of course. So when we have an intercalation, we cannot, because if we have one series of rock continuous for some length, then we can design differently. But if when we have intercalation, we have one layer of very thin, very weak rock, and then we have one layer, for example, typical in Nepal is Kalai and Metasandstone. They are very typical. So they intercalate each other very well. So when you have sandstone layer on the roof, the stability is quite good, right? But when you have Kalai on the top, so then the Kalai part we fell off, because it has very low contact with metasandstone, because metasandstone beds are very planar. There is no frictional possibilities there. So it is likely that mass will fall down. So in that sense, so the best way is that we make an overall global assessment of the rock mass and then make a common approach to both of them. If it is intercalating very frequently, but if you have a bed, for example, a sandstone bed that will continue for 10-20 meters, so then you optimize the support to address the sandstone, not for the current.
In most in our case, what happens? So we have a quartzite and we sissify, because in the field we treat each is a quartzite, which is a hard rock. But in our case, in Nepal, Himalaya, I have seen there, some quartzites are very pure, and others are partings of clay layers, say phyllites and slates, some pyritic layers, you know. And in this case, the quartzite cannot be treated as a like a quartzite, a single.
No, we shouldn't do that. So therefore, we must be careful when we do the mapping, because when we see a foliated quartzite, schistose quartzite, so it is very easy to see because quartzite is much brighter in such position. So it is between metasandstone and quartzite. It has not gone through the complete quartzite formation yet. So it is somewhere between there. So this is very easy to identify. So if we are little smart and we try to make our hand into rubbish or muddy, so it is very easy. So this is the part. So those of us who like to touch soil, sand, rocks, and those who like to climb the mountains are on the rock engineers and engineering geologists and geologists. So those who sit in the office and then just do the calculation, they are not rock engineers. They are not geologists or engineering geologists.
Thank you again for this presentation, which was the very last presentation of this HKT before the concluding session after the lunch. I think we have seeing Paul and heard four great talks on very relevant topics for the society. And I want to thank all speakers again. We are now about half an hour behind our schedule, and I think the organizers should say something about when the concluding session after the lunch will start. So thank you, everybody.
Coach Dr. Chhatra Bahadur Pasnet.